This is Naked Mormonism.
I pledge my life, all that I may have. I will strive to the utmost of my ability to be what you would want me to be.
It's time to find the truth.
And having set our hand to the plow, we will never look back until this work is finished.
Where is the church heading?
I have faith that the Constitution will be saved as prophesied by Joseph Smith. But it will not be saved in Washington. It will be saved by enlightened members of this church.
The explicit tag is there for a reason. So if you get offended at what's said, it's not for you. But most importantly,
may you ponder the truths you've heard. May they help you become even better than you were.
Skepticize everything.
Welcome to episode 21 of the Naked Mormonism podcast. I'm Bryce Blankenagle, and thank you for joining me. Last episode was a little step out of the normal history. It was time to give Boyd K. Packer the proper eulogy that he so thoroughly deserved. I grabbed three of his more famous talks and read the majority of their content to try and get a proper understanding of this man's views on sexuality in general and everything relating to it. I hope the episode didn't get too personal at the end there. I've spent a lot of time with you guys by this point, and it felt like I should let you in on my Mormon experience a little bit more than I have in the past. It's quite apparent that I hold a bit of frustration with the church's stances on sexuality, and I kind of let that frustration take its own course and direct the content of my rantings. Not only that, but the episode was filled with ad hominem attacks and name-calling. It came to my attention from a few people that some of the names that I called Boyd K. Packer might have been a bit offensive. Names like Boyd KKK Fudge Packer and Boyd K. Packet in the Ass and just outright Dick Licker. I'm well aware of how offensive these names can be, so to anybody that did take offense, I do apologize. It was and is never my intention to offend or hurt anybody with what I say on this show. I like to be offensive in the scope of the show, but I mean absolutely no harm to anybody directly, with the exception of the relevant people we talk about in the show. I have no problem calling Joe the megalomaniacal, child-fucking, self-righteous pile of human waste that he was, or calling Boyd K. Packer the disconnected, fear-mongering, misogynistic, gay-hating fuckwit that he was, but I try to stop the insults and ad hominem attacks there. There were a few reasons that I was so offensive. One of which was just to poke the dead bear. You see, the most offensive thing you can do to a violent homophobe is libelously call them various offensive terms for being gay. The best way to highlight someone's bigotry is by shining a spotlight on how offended a person like that is when the names are turned around and used on them. I think I was doing just that, in an effort to make a homophobic person like Packer uncomfortable by calling him what he hates most. It shows a problem with their perspective, not with society's perspective. I would never actually call somebody that's gay one of these horrible names. I hope that hearing those phrases didn't turn anybody off of the rest of the show, because by the end of it, I try to express just how pro-gay I am. I would never dream of saying something offensive like that in an effort to offend anybody that's gay, or for that matter, anybody that's straight and sympathizes with the LGBT movement like myself. Unintentional collateral offense is never my intention with this show. The second reason for calling these names was just out of sheer frustration. In reading those talks, I created a cardboard version of Packer that I couldn't help but verbally stab a bunch of times for saying such insensitive and horrible things. As I made apparent in the episode, I had a hard time controlling how angry the content made me, because I empathized so much with the people he marginalized during the talks. It was childish and petulant, but I don't think it was unjustified. I think another reason, which I sort of alluded to during the closing rant, was the fact that I was raised with terms like this being normal, like calling my buddy names for killing me in Call of Duty, for instance. I knew that he wasn't gay and therefore probably didn't suck cocks. I was fairly certain that he didn't make a habit of fucking his mother or being a 6-foot-tall excretory organ, but I still called him a cock-sucking motherfucking asshole for scoring a cross-map headshot on me. Anybody that's played any first-person shooter with a notorious screen peeker has said similar things to them. These were never exchanged in genuine anger or meant to be truly offensive to the other person. It was merely done out of a weird sense of joking that's exchanged between men every day. I mean, I'm a delivery truck driver that spends my working day going from auto repair shop to the next diesel repair shop in very rural parts of Colorado, Wyoming, and Nebraska. If you don't have a vocabulary and skin that can handle and return these words, you're seen as a pinko commie hippie Obama lover, and you will not survive, especially as a salesman. I'm not trying to shift the blame onto my past or current situation, but I moved from a very conservative suburb of Salt Lake City to very rural conservative Colorado, and I just described my job. I don't spend much time around very many people that I would consider enlightened. This show has been my first access to that world and group of people. The problem with this is I don't always have a baseline of reality to ground my speech and mannerisms upon. I mean, for fuck's sake, I went to bed just after midnight, both nights of reason gone, because I haven't really partied before. Mormonism made me into a fucking weird young adult. The culmination of these many compounding reasons is what made me say such things. I'm not trying to justify it because I know I never should have said what I did in the way that I did it. Saying those things was completely my responsibility and was never my intention, and I'm sorry. I hope all you listeners can accept my apology with the understanding that I will be more careful from now on with how I express my frustration at ass-backwards worldviews held by really fucked up people like Boyd K. Packer and Joseph Smith. I do appreciate the corrections, though. They help me become a better person and make the show more listener-friendly. Hopefully I've made my stance clear on stuff like this, so we don't have to start out an episode on a low note like this. So now for the fun stuff that everybody comes to this show for, the history of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Let's get a quick refresher course on what the last historical episode was about. Last time we were talking about Joseph and Company, they had signed the contract with E.B. Grandin to publish 5,000 copies of the Book of Mormon for $3,000, while Ollie and John Whitmer were slaving away to compose the printer's manuscript, and John H. Gilbert was madly setting the type and printing, Joe just sort of fucked off to Harmony to go live with the in-laws again. Sometime during this period, Joe heard about a publishing company in Canada that was willing to pay a very handsome $8,000 for any book or copyright that could be useful, whatever that meant, and of course, he wanted in on some of that cheddar. He gathered a few of his favorite gents, minus Not-So-Smarty Marty, of course, because he didn't want him knowing about it, and then gave them all revelation to go sell the copyright in Canada. It failed the first time. I know, hard to believe that one of Joe's revelations from God failed or was inaccurate somehow, but Joe wouldn't be dismayed by this little speed bump. He called for the same group of buddies to go on a second trip to Canada, once again by revelation from God, and the group failed a second time. Amazing, isn't it? It's just sad that we don't have a copy of that revelation itself. We know that both trips happened and their purpose from multiple first-hand accounts, but Joe wouldn't let the revelation be printed because it was such a massive embarrassment to him that the revelation was such a fail. After these multiple failed revelations, a guy named Abner Cole printed a satirical version of the Book of Mormon under the pen name Obadiah Dogberry, and he called it the Book of Pukei. He also unlawfully printed the first two chapters of the Book of Mormon in the newspaper, which finally made Joe and company take notice and have a little talk with Mr. Dogberry. Soon after this, the plagiarism and copyright infringement stopped. However, the ridicule did not. There is plenty more out there from newspapers and multiple other sources that consider Joe and his golden Bible that he found with his magic stone precious to be a complete farcical and nefarious fraud. Joe was pretty much universally considered a piece of shit by anybody that wasn't in his company or didn't have some way of benefiting from believing his story or being part of the early Mormonite movement. Well, after talking about the Book of Pukei, we concluded the episode by saying this was the end of the road leading up to the Church of Christ being started and the beginning of Joe's journey to full-blown cult leader. We bumped right up to the first congregation of the church, which was held on April 6th, 1830. Well, that's where we begin today's episode, along with the introduction of a character that we've ignored for far too long. So, let's get into it. This was a pretty eventful day for Joe and his friends, April 6, 1830. We know the major parts of what happened that day. However, there are some minutiae that are controversial. One problem is the number of people in the congregation. Some have recorded that there may have been as many as 30 people gathered together there, whereas the church reports 6 active members on that day. Another issue is the location. The church tells us that it was organized in the Whitmer home in Fayette, New York. However, others argue that it was organized in or near the Smith home in the Manchester-Palmyra area. Like I said, they're small details. Details that don't necessarily change anything important about the occurrences of that day, but they are worth mentioning. For our purposes, we're going to stick primarily with the report from the History of the Church, Volume 1. Thanks again, Jay, for sending a copy of this to me. It's absolutely invaluable. This episode will be quoting straight from it, pages 75 to 94. Starting on page 75, quote, "We had received a commandment to organize the church, and accordingly we met together for that purpose at the house of Mr. Peter Whitmer Sr., being 6 in number, on Tuesday, the 6th day of April A.D. 1830. Having opened the meeting by solemn prayer to our Heavenly Father, we proceeded, according to previous commandment, to call on our brethren to know whether they accepted us as their teachers in the things of the kingdom of God, and whether they were satisfied that we should proceed and be organized as a church according to said commandment which we had received. To these several propositions they consented by a unanimous vote. I then laid my hands upon Oliver Cowdery, and ordained him an elder of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, after which he ordained me also to the office of an elder of said church. We then took bread, blessed it, and brake it with them. Also wine, blessed it, and drank it with them. We then laid our hands on each individual member of the church present, that they might receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, and be confirmed members of the Church of Christ. The Holy Ghost was poured out upon us to a very great degree. Some prophesied, whilst we all praised the Lord and rejoiced exceedingly." End quote. Alright, let's talk about this for a minute. Naturally, the meeting was opened with a prayer. That's to be perfectly expected. But the next thing they do is what I'm interested in. They, quote, "called on our brethren to know whether they accepted us as their teachers in the kingdom of God, and whether they were satisfied that we should proceed to be organized as a church," end quote. When I was young in the church, I always wondered why we would do that thing right before the sacrament service, where they would call people and ask the congregation to sustain or oppose the person's calling or appointment. Once every 6 months during general conference, some dude in a $900 suit will stand at the pulpit in the conference center and ask all the members to sustain the current leadership, which is basically just raising your hand and saying you support whatever it is they just said. I suppose it's always an option to oppose whatever they're calling your support for, but that's relatively unheard of until recently with the anti-opposed movement. You never knew the church was such a democratic structure, did you? Anyway, I remember thinking a few times that it was so weird, but it was also just what everybody else in the church was doing, so I didn't ever question it, seriously. It seems like this line that was quoted might be the genesis of this practice. At the very first congregation of the church, Joe called for a vote from everybody in the room, asking if they supported Joe and Ollie as their teachers and agreed with the direction the church was going. I suppose I see the point of this effort. If any member isn't satisfied, they can just vote against supporting a motion, and the motion needs to be adopted or changed in order to obtain satisfaction. I suppose that's more of a republic than a democracy, but it still surprises me that in its very early stages, the church was practicing this, and it's still part of every LDS church's agenda every week. Just a heads up, you don't oppose. Simple as that, you just don't oppose. Next thing to address is Joe and Ollie's little mutual masterboardination into the office of elder in the church. The footnotes of this history of the church that I'm reading from, which were added many years later, vehemently distinguish this ordination apart from Joe and Ollie receiving the Melchizedek priesthood, so it can fit better into their narrative, of course. However, from reading the recorded history up to this point and ignoring the footnotes, it seems a lot like Joe considered the office of elder synonymous with the Melchizedek priesthood. In fact, the Melchizedek priesthood hadn't even been referred to up to this point. It was just the holy priesthood in reference to the Aaronic priesthood, and then the office of elder, which nowadays has the added bonus of the Melchizedek priesthood, and it was added much later than what's recorded here. Check out episode 19 for a full deconstruction of the massive fustercluck of confused timelines and verbiage when it comes to the priesthoods. Just keep in mind, when the church was first organized, elder was considered the highest office for a person to reach in the priesthood, with the exception of Joe, which is what we'll talk about next. Let's go back to quoting from the History of the Church, Volume 1. Keep in mind the perspective given by Joseph being the mouthpiece of God when he gave revelations. Quote, "Whilst yet together, I received the following commandment." He's about to give us one of his famous revelations. Here we go. "Behold, there shall be a record kept among you, and in it thou shalt be called a seer, translator, a prophet, an apostle of Jesus Christ, and elder of the church through the will of God the Father and the grace of your Lord Jesus Christ. Being inspired of the Holy Ghost to lay the foundation thereof and to build it up unto the most holy faith." End quote. Basically, everybody in the congregation got something cool for being there. See, Joe and Ollie ordained each other into the office of elder, and then every person in the congregation voted on their holiness and thus received the ordination blessing of the Holy Ghost. And then everybody was happy, apparently. But Joe couldn't stay on the same level as all the other people in this burgeoning cult. He needed some way to distinguish himself above all the other fools in that room. So, Joe received a convenient revelation from God that set him apart as seer, translator, prophet, and apostle of Jesus Christ. That was a title that nobody, not even Ollie Cowdung all over, had. Joe officially set himself up as King Shit of Crazyville in just those few sentences. Welcome to the first official authority claim of our favorite cult leader, Joseph Smith. Going back to the History of the Church, Volume 1, starting page 79, quote, "We now proceeded to call out and ordain some others of the brethren to different offices of the priesthood, according as the Spirit manifested unto us, and after a happy time spent in witnessing and feeling for ourselves the powers and blessings of the Holy Ghost, through the grace of God bestowed upon us, we dismissed with the pleasing knowledge that we were now individually member of and acknowledged of God, the Church of Jesus Christ, organized in accordance with commandments and revelations given by Him to ourselves in these last days, as well as according to the churches recorded in the New Testament. Several persons who had attended the above meeting became convinced of the truth, and came forward shortly after, and were received into the church. Among the rest, my own father and mother were baptized, to my great joy and consolation, and about the same time, Martin Harris and Orrin Porter Rockwell." End quote. Before we get to the last person on that list, let's talk about the other three people. Apparently, Joe was convincing enough with his revelations and other speeches during this first congregation that both his parents and not-so-smarty Marty were baptized into the church. That's important for a certain level of validation that Joe had been seeking for a long time. I mean, obviously, Joe looked up to his parents, especially his magical father, Big Daddy Cheese, who was obviously Joe's namesake. I mean, at the time of recording this, I'm the same age as Joe was when he was conducting this meeting, and he had the implicit approval of his parents and crazy-ass bipolar deer whisperer not-so-smarty Marty. What a rock-solid validation, right? I mean, even being his age, I can't put myself in his shoes for gaining that level of validation from the people he cared most about. Before moving on to Orrin Porter Rockwell, let me read off the official list of the first six members of that first congregation. there was Joe, Ollie Cowdung, Hiram Smith, Peter Whitmer Jr., Samuel Smith, and D-Day David Whitmer. The list was given by Oliver to Joseph Knight Sr., who will come up really soon. This attendance list seems to lack the names of the individuals baptized on that day. They must have only counted the members that had already been baptized or something, because it doesn't make a lot of sense if Big Daddy Cheese, Lucy Smith, and Not-So-Smarty Marty were baptized that day, but weren't there to be baptized. The same goes for Orrin Porter Rockwell. It's starting to seem like the history as recorded by the church doesn't quite match up to reality in this case, but I don't know. I wasn't there to judge the accuracy of the record. I wonder what else is wrong with it. We'll get into that question in a while, but first, let's talk about OPR. Orrin Porter Destroying Motherfucking Angel Rockwell was born in Belchertown, Massachusetts on June 28, 1813, to Orrin and Sarah Rockwell. His father's name was spelled with one R instead of two R's, like Orrin Porter was, and they soon moved to Palmyra, New York. In mid-1818, the Smith family moved to Palmyra, New York as well, to the farmhouse adjacent to the Rockwell farm. Orrin was 8 years younger than Joseph, but both boys shared some things in common. During the first episode of this show, we talked about Joe having surgery on his infected leg bone due to a bone infection from typhoid fever. It was an experimental procedure that involved opening up the leg and scraping away the infected bone tissue. This left Joe with a long recovery time in his youth, all the way up to his early teenage years. Joe had a limp until the day he died, thanks to that single operation. However, he didn't die from the infection, so it was a life-saving procedure. Well, Orrin had a very similar experience. However, he didn't have a leg infection that required a major surgery. He just severely broke his leg at the age of 10. And had it set and placed in a makeshift cast by a shitty physician. This cast allowed him to heal, however, the leg healed and ended up 2 inches shorter than the other leg. This forever gave Orrin a limp as well, making it something the boys shared with each other and could bond over. In fact, Orrin's 2-inch difference was problematic enough that he wasn't very useful for some farming tasks. For example, when plowing, he could never plow in a straight line. He thought he was, but when somebody would come along to check his work, all the lines leaned in one direction a tiny bit, making an unruly mess of the field. Even given the age difference, Joe and Orrin became the best of friends. While Joe was more the thinking type, Orrin was more the get shit done and fuck you up type. Both boys were a little bit odd or goofy in their own way, and the other boys in town would frequently make fun of them for being crippled or weird or visionary or some other thing that boys make fun of each other for. This little us-versus-them mentality united Joe and Orrin in a way that can't be shared by people that haven't experienced their situation. Joe himself was known for scrapping with the neighborhood boys occasionally. However, he was kind of a pipsqueak in comparison to some of the other bigger farm boys, so he would frequently get his ass kicked when a confrontation would turn into a fight. This is really no different than any other boy growing up during that time. Shit, this is how a lot of boys are growing up today. Only recently has society started seeing a turn against fighting and bullying in schools and neighborhoods between boys. Well, where Joe was lacking in muscle, Orrin seemed to excel. He was simply tougher than a lot of the neighborhood boys, especially Joe. This gave the two of them a very interesting friendship that will become very useful for Joe in the very near future in our timeline. It isn't until 1838 that Orrin really starts to embody the spirit of the destroying angel of the church, but he had the personality for it long before he actually fell into this role. Orrin was a tough bastard. My absolute favorite part about him was the fact that he had a high-pitched voice. A man like this, you picture being rough, tough, and having a gruff voice. However, his was higher pitched than normal, and under times of distress, it became even higher pitched. So he'd be like, "Hey, are you looking at my short leg? Stop making fun of me, asshole!" If you look at a picture of this guy, he looks like a biker yeti. Somebody you would picture having a scruff, intimidating voice, but no, it just sounded ridiculous. The best part about his voice was his catchphrase. whenever something happened that he liked or he just wanted to exclaim something out of excitement, he would yell, "Wheat!" Or should I say, "Wheat!" A lot of the locals called Joseph a vagrant and a drunkard, following in the steps of his fantastic father figure, Big Daddy Cheese. Well, this was something else that brought the two young men together. Oren thoroughly enjoyed his alcohol, tobacco, and foul mouth. Joe and Oren were two peas in a bullshit pod. But don't get me wrong, Hiram and Joe were really good friends, but they were also brothers, which is totally different than the friend dynamic that Oren and Joe had. Even Ollie Cowdung was Joe's cousin, making their friendship slightly less dynamic than that of Joe and Oren. The way I picture Ollie and Joe's relationship was a bit more master-slave or commander and actor. Ollie kinda just did whatever Joe said. However, Oren was much stronger than Ollie, both physically and in will and personality. Joe couldn't control Oren the way he could with Ollie, so he had to find ways to fuel Oren's ego and point it in the right direction, as opposed to break him with commands from God like Joe did with Ollie or Hiram or any of his other cronies. These personality profiles that I'm proposing here aren't baseless. We have a couple of situations to help illustrate or bring to life the relationships these guys had with each other. Let's take what happened during the translation of the Book of Mormon with Ollie to understand his and Joe's relationship a little better. Sometime during the supposed 3-month period of translating the Book of Mormon, Ollie thought that he might be able to translate some himself and have Joe scribe for him. Well, Joe came up with a revelation that told Ollie that if he had faith in the Lord and his own abilities, he would have the gift of translation just like Joe. Ollie attempted to come up with some of the Book of Mormon, which was never printed and is lost to historical mystery. Soon after this attempt, Joe came up with another revelation from God that Ollie was to be Joe's assistant and scribe for Joe and never do anything else. This may have been because Ollie wasn't very good at translating, but I tend to go the other way. I believe that the revelations slash translations that Ollie gave were too awesome, in Joe's opinion anyway. Not wanting to be shown up by his lackey, Joe came up with revelations stating that Ollie didn't possess the same powers as Joe, therefore his revelations were inferior and would never be shared with the church. And that's why they aren't printed and we don't have them today. A similar situation happened with Hiram Page, which is something we've talked about before, but without any real context of when the situation fell into the timeline. Sometime just after the organization of the church, during one of the early assemblies, Hiram Page tried his hand at revelating through his own precious seer stone. We aren't really sure why Hiram did this, but one prevailing theory was that the new congregants weren't fully convinced of Joe's authority or connection to the divine. A few episodes ago, when we talked about this, I said it was because Joe was dragging his feet when it came to telling the congregants where the final gathering place of the rapture was, or where this brand new church planned on putting the new Jerusalem that Joe kept talking about. I tend to think that this is what the revelation that Page gave was about, but we aren't really certain why Hiram did this. Primarily because we don't have the revelation available to us to speculate on or try to draw conclusions from. Usually, when we see the content of a revelation, it's pretty easy to surmise why it was given or speculate on the situation that necessitated the revelation in the first place. Unfortunately, we can't do this with Page's revelation. Regardless of why he tried giving revelation on behalf of the church, once Joe found out, in typical take-my-ball-and-go-home fashion, Joe ordered the revelation to be burned, and the stone that Hiram used crushed into dust, because the revelation was obviously from the devil! I'm sure it had nothing to do with the fact that it was a blatant subversion of Joe's supposedly divine authority. It was clearly just because the revelation was evil. I mean, honestly, this was just a manifestation of Joe stomping out the competition in his own ranks. What's more than that, he ordered Ollie to go tell Hiram that the revelation was not of God, and that Hiram was to destroy it and his stone. Ollie was just the go-to guy here. Joe also told both of them that the stoned site was to be left up to Joe and Joe alone. This was just another power play by him. Now let's compare that revelation to a revelation that Joe gave to Oren and try to see the difference. During one of Oren's many batshit crazy gun-toting stunts during which he faced certain death, he somehow emerged on the other side without so much as a scratch. In the aftermath, Joe gave Oren a revelation that if he never cut his hair, he would never be harmed by blade or bullet. Do you see the difference in revelation that I'm talking about? One was used to quell and destroy the ego and free spirit of two people, and the other was meant to feed the parasitic ego of Oren. I think Joe had a kind of unspoken respect for him. I think he understood that he couldn't control Oren the same way he could other people. He could merely point him in the desired direction and hope that everything turned out the best for everybody. This brings us to our official Naked Mormonism nickname for Oren Porter Rockwell. Old Pistol Packin' Porter. His friends knew him as Old Port. Now you see why Pistol Packin' Porter is one of my favorite people in the entire Mormon history. He was not only a loose cannon, but a complete reckless badass that enjoyed the carnality of life and killing more than he cared for the life of piety, and he refused to be completely controlled by Joe's iron fist. One of his best traits was the fact that he was completely illiterate for most of his life and died only semi-literate, meaning he never read the Book of Mormon to know what he was really following. He just took Joe's word for it whenever he was given instructions, and old Port was proud of this bit of ignorance. I mean, there just isn't another wild card quite like this in all of Mormon history. Old Oren Pistol Packin' Porter Rockwell didn't give no fucks and didn't give a fuck who gave a fuck about it. He did his own thing, all while under the banner of Joe's heaven and was directed by Joe's self-serving whims. Old Port was responsible for a lot more than what we'll cover in this episode, but this is the official introduction of this dynamic, controversial, and all-around amazing character in our timeline. Pistol Packin' Port became the youngest person to be baptized and confirmed into the church during its first congregation, being around 17 at the time. The reason I say around is because there's a little argument about whether he was born in 1813 or 1815. I figured if I say around 17, it pretty much covers both bases and gets closest to actual fact, excusing a little ambiguity. So, Big Daddy Cheese, Lucy Mack Smith, Not So Smarty Marty, and Pistol Packin' Port were the first four people to be baptized in the church during that Tuesday session on April 6, 1830. These baptisms, along with calling some of the brethren that were already members to leadership positions, pretty much covers everything that happened during that session. So let's move on to the first actual Sunday assembly of the church on April 11, 1830. But before moving on to that, it might be a good idea to talk about the evolution of Joe's revelations throughout his leadership in the church. When he was just starting out, the revelations seemed to be for purely utility purposes. A need arises in the church, and Joe comes up with a very basic, bare-bones revelation to fix the problem, and everybody follows orders and moves on. This is the stage we're at now with the revelations. During this early period, Joe was still using Precious and Mr. Hat to ensure accuracy of his revelation from the Almighty God of the Universe, of course, whereas very soon he leaves the props behind and just slips into an almost trance-like state to do his revelating. Then he gets to a point where he just comes up with revelation to best suit his needs. He starts to condemn people more during the revelations, and calls himself the Lord thy God more frequently, and adds a significant amount more fluff. By the time the saints get to Missouri, every revelation spends one or two verses dealing with the problem that it's meant to fix, and everything else in the section is just a sermon calling people to repentance, or telling people to trust him, because, you know, he's totally speaking for God, and nobody can challenge that. As we advance in the storyline, it'll be easier to see these differences in Joe's revelation. It's quite fascinating, and I'll try to point out the differences as much as possible when they come up. But let me give an example of a bare-bones revelation like I've been talking about. This was either issued at the April 6th congregation, or it might have been given during the first Sunday assembly on the 11th. It's not really clear, and it really doesn't matter too much. What we're concerned with is the content of the revelation. I'm once again taking this from History of the Church, Volume 1, and it's on page 80. It's worth briefly pointing out that I'll be spending most of this episode in this book. It's what the church tells us about itself, and it's extremely revealing. And as far as historians can tell, this version aligns with reality quite closely. Keeping all the historical facts in mind, where we get to play around on this show is reading in between those lines, or trying to speculate on the real-world need for a given revelation. That's our playground. For example, this revelation I'm about to read is given to multiple new members of the church and was obviously born out of necessity. The people in this revelation were obviously asking Joe what God wanted them to do in order to further the kingdom of God, aka Joe's church. Quoting from History of the Church, Volume 1, quote, "Behold, I speak unto you, Oliver, a few words. Behold, thou art blessed, and art under no condemnation, but beware of pride, lest thou shouldst enter into temptation. Make known thy calling unto the church, and also before the world, and thy heart shall be open to preach the truth from henceforth and forever. Amen. Behold, I speak unto you, Hiram, a few words. For thou also art under no condemnation, and thy heart is opened, and thy tongue loosed, and thy calling is to exhortation, and to strengthen the church continually. Wherefore thy duty is unto the church forever, and this because of thy family. Amen. Behold, I speak a few words unto you, Samuel. For thou also art under no condemnation, and thy calling is to exhortation and to strengthen the church. And thou art not as yet called to preach before the world. Amen. Behold, I speak a few words unto you, Joseph." That was Big Daddy Cheese. "For thou also art under no condemnation, and thy calling also is to exhortation and to strengthen the church. And this is thy duty from henceforth and forever. Amen. Behold, I manifest unto you, Joseph Knight, by these words, that you must take up your cross, in the which you must pray vocally before the world as well as in secret, and in your family and among your friends and in all places. And behold, it is your duty to unite with the true church, and give your language to exhortation continually, that you may receive the reward of the laborer. Amen." End quote. You see what I mean? At this stage, Joe was trying on all kinds of different ideas to see what worked, and what could be best utilized to control the people around him that were members of the church. He was just at the beginning of this crazy theological evolution when the church was first organized. In the grand scheme of things, Joe had barely gotten started. The church hadn't moved to Ohio yet, where it would more than double in size. The history of the church wasn't being officially recorded by anybody yet. Joe's revelations hadn't been compiled into the Book of Commandments yet. Joe hadn't even started on his translation of the Bible with Sidney Rigdon yet. In fact, by the church's recorded history, Joe hadn't even met Hingepin Rigdon by this point. The Pratt brothers weren't around quite yet. Brigham Young was still completely ignorant to the entire Mormon movement. Missionary forces had yet to be formally organized. There had been a few people here and there that had been sent out with incomplete copies of the Book of Mormon for the purpose of being missionaries. However, the first full-on missionary force of the church was still waiting to be organized under Joe's direction. As a matter of fact, the revelation we just read was the formal calling of Hiram, Samuel, and Big Daddy Cheese, along with sort of Joseph Knight Sr., to be the first missionaries for the church. Everything's in its very early stages. Joe was taking baby steps day by day to organize the church. It wasn't all revealed at once in its current form, as is usually understood by believing Mormons today. You would think that if the church were indeed restored from the one true church that Jesus created, it would be restored through the perfect and almighty God of the universe, and would therefore be brought to fruition all at once through perfect means, and never need to be changed from what was originally uttered by Joe. I mean, I suppose we'll have to see if there are any differences from the original church to today's church, and it would seem like it might falsify the claim of divine origin based on that premise alone. I suppose we'll just find out, won't we? Anyways, let's move on to the rest of what happened during that first Sunday meeting in Fayette. Once again, we return to the History of the Church, Volume 1. Quote, "On Sunday, April 11th, 1830, Oliver Cowdery preached the first public discourse that was delivered by any of our number. Our meeting was held by previous appointment at the house of Mr. Peter Whitmer Sr., Fayette. Large numbers of people attended, and the same day the following were baptized. List Hiram Page, Catherine Page, Christian Whitmer, Ann Whitmer, Jacob Whitmer, Elizabeth Whitmer, and on the 18th day, that was the following week, Peter Whitmer Sr., Mary Whitmer, William Jolly, Elizabeth Jolly, Vincent Jolly, Richard B. Peterson, and Elizabeth Ann Whitmer, all by Oliver Cowdery and Seneca Lake." End quote. So Joe wasn't responsible for any of the actual work there. First off, why did Ollie Cowdery deliver the first actual public discourse on the church? It just seems odd, doesn't it? Why wouldn't Joe, the prophet of God and mouthpiece of divine revelation, be the person to deliver the first sermon? Or to baptize the first people? I'm not sure it's relevant at all, but doesn't it seem odd? Nobody knew the Book of Mormon better than Joe because it all came from his mind. However, his right-hand man was the first person to give everybody the first lesson about the Book of Mormon and early Mormonism. Oh well, like I said, I don't think it matters too much. What does seem to matter was who baptized all of the new people that wanted to join the church. For some reason, this responsibility also fell on Ollie's shoulders. Was Joe so holy of a prophet that he couldn't be bothered with being the person to physically baptize these people that wanted to fall into line with him? I don't know if this is why, but I want to try and speculate on why Joe conducted the church this way. I personally think that Joe was trying to elevate himself above the temporal rituals and whatnot that were necessary to run the church. It's like any boss at any job ever. The boss may or may not know how to perform a simple task in the company, but he or she never will, because it's a big degree of separation between the boss and the lowly worker underneath that boss. Well, I think the same thing was going on with the Joe and Ollie dynamic here. Joe wanted everybody to see him as being above what they had to do in order to reach God. Joe wanted to portray himself as already being the closest man to God that existed on earth. How could he be above everybody else in that respect if he is required by God to perform everything that the lowly peasants in his church have to do? Now, granted, that's just my opinion, but doesn't it seem to make a little bit of sense? I mean, if I were a cult leader, I wouldn't be one of the guys hoeing the weeds out of the garden. I'd be the dude sitting in a red velvet chair, cigar and expensive scotch in hand, overlooking the masses as they do my bidding. That's just how cult leading works. But like I said, this is just speculation. Another piece of speculation to offer here is a possible explanation for why some historians think that the first congregation happened in Palmyra as opposed to Fayette. It has primarily to do with the people that were baptized during the meeting on the 6th as opposed to who joined on the 11th. All of the people that joined during the 6th were residing in the Palmyra, Manchester area during the time. And it's not necessarily easy to believe that all of them would travel to Fayette on a Tuesday just to be part of the first congregation. Additionally, why wouldn't all those Whitmers that were baptized on the 11th just get baptized during the first congregation if it was in their own house, as opposed to waiting 5 more days just to be baptized on the first Sunday assembly? It just doesn't make sense. But if you posit the claim that the first congregation was held in Palmyra, and the first Sunday assembly was held 30 miles away in Fayette 5 days after this first congregation, the names of the people make more sense. Martin Harris, Big Daddy Cheese, Lucy Smith, and old Pistol Packin' Porter were all in Palmyra and were baptized on the 6th. However, Hiram Page, Catherine Page, Christian Whitmer, blah blah blah, all of those people that I read off earlier were all in Fayette at this time and were baptized on the 11th or on the 18th of April. Like I said earlier, this is a very small and irrelevant detail, but I figured it might be useful to hash out the controversy and consider what fits the evidence best. And once again, the recorded Mormon version, for whatever reason, conflicts with very simple logic. I can't figure out why they so strongly assert that the first congregation was in Fayette on April 6th. when it just doesn't make sense when it's that way. Moving on, let's find out what happens next. The first congregation of the church had been convened and was over with. The first Sunday assembly of the church and the first official sermon had been given, and lots of people had been baptized. Now we can move on to the actual missionary efforts in the early church. The church had some very polarizing doctrine. People would accept or reject it wholly. There weren't a lot of people that were in the middle. The church and its doctrine radically divided families and friends. Within the first 9 months of the church, the first group of six people were excommunicated from the church. They were just the beginning of it. The only way that the church would be able to survive was aggressive expansion through proselyting. They could only keep the church going if they were constantly gaining new members and consuming new ground. If the missionary force slowed, new members stopped coming in and the bleeding of members overtook the number of newcomers. As could be expected, Joe decided to do a bit of the missionary work himself. However, he didn't go tracking strangers' doorsteps like the other early missionaries did. He went to secure high-value targets. One of these was the family of Joseph Knight Sr. Going back to the History of the Church, Volume 1, quote, "During this month of April, I went on a visit to the residence of Mr. Joseph Knight of Colesville, Broome County, New York, with whom and his family I had been for some time acquainted, and whose name I had previously mentioned as having been so kind and thoughtful towards us while translating the Book of Mormon. Mr. Knight and his family were Universalists, but were willing to reason with me upon my religious views, and were, as usual, friendly and hospitable. We held several meetings in the neighborhood. We had many friends and some enemies. Our meetings were well attended, and many began to pray fervently to Almighty God that he would give them wisdom to understand the truth." End quote. The kindness and thoughtfulness that Joe mentioned there was the time during late May to early June of 1829 that Joseph Knight Sr. brought some food and other provisions to the starving newlywed Joseph and Emma that were translating the book with Ollie in Harmony, Pennsylvania. This was at a time that they desperately needed any help they could get because Isaac Hale had cut off any assistance he was giving them, and Joe and Ollie were busy all day playing with their book as opposed to working for a living. There was no income to the household, and they couldn't bum meals off of the Hale family anymore, so Joseph Knight Sr. showed up in the nick of time to keep their current lifestyle alive. Of course, barely a week after this nice gesture, they all moved to the Whitmer home and there received free room and board for the remaining duration of authoring the Book of Mormon. After Joe talks about Joseph Knight's hospitality, he tells us that he started a congregation of the church in Colesville. The Knights ended up converting to the church. Fortunately for us, it's not just as simple as Joe reasoning them into the church before they converted. For the Knight family conversion story, we need to dive back into the history of the church. This reading will be a bit longer, but hang in there with me because it tells us some really crazy shit, and I think it helps to illustrate why the Knights converted from Universalism to Joe's Church of Christ. Just a side note here, there really isn't a whole lot of difference between the 1830s version of Universalism and what Joe was preaching. Joe just created a structured version of what most Universalists believed at the time, that nobody would go to hell and that everybody would universally be living with God somehow when they died. But let's get to the important and more realistic version of why the Knights converted. This is starting on page 82 of Volume 1 of the History of the Church, and I think people can empathize with conversion stories like this a little bit. Quote, "Our meetings were well attended," that was meetings in Colesville that it's talking about, "and many began to pray fervently to Almighty God that he would give them wisdom to understand the truth. Amongst those who attended our meetings regularly was Newell Knight, son of Joseph Knight. He and I had many serious conversations on the important subject of man's eternal salvation. We had got into the habit of praying much at our meetings." So they were like Googling shit here. "And Newell had said that he would try and take up his cross and pray vocally during the meeting. But when we again met together, he rather excused himself.
I tried to prevail upon him, making use of the figure. Supposing that he should get into a mud hole, would he not try to help himself out? And I further said that we were willing now to help him out of the mud hole. He replied that provided he had got into a mud hole through carelessness, he would rather wait and get out himself than to have others help him. And so he would wait until he could get into the woods by himself, and there he would pray. Accordingly, he deferred praying until next morning, when he retired into the woods, where, according to his own account afterwards, he made several attempts to pray, but could scarcely do so. Feeling that he had not done his duty in refusing to pray in the presence of others, he began to feel uneasy, and continued to feel worse both in mind and body, until, upon reaching his own house, his appearance was such as to alarm his wife very much. He requested her to go and bring me to him. I went and found him suffering very much in his mind, and his body acted upon in a very strange manner. His visage and limbs were distorted and twisted in every shape and appearance possible to imagine. And finally, he was caught up off the floor of the apartment and tossed about most fearfully. End quote. Okay, so this is the first time we've talked about demon possession on this show, but here it is. Right in the church's own published history, Newell Knight was apparently possessed by demons because he didn't want to pray in public or something. So he comes home one day looking like shit, and his wife goes and gets Joe to have him cast out these demons. Or maybe just see what he can do with the situation. Well, Joe shows up and Newell is in bad shape. According to Joe, literally in bad shape, like his limbs were distorted and all twisty and fucky and whatnot. Then somehow Newell levitated off the floor of the apartment and was tossed around like a fucking demon puppet ragdoll. I've heard this story related before, that Newell was just bouncing around in the rafters of the building like a ping pong demon toy. I personally believe that this is a bit of an over-dramatization of the story. I think he was just laying on the floor, then a blood vessel in his head burst from the high fever he was fighting, taking out a small portion of his brain along with it, and that sent him into a delusional rage or possibly a mild seizure of some sort, and he just threw himself around the room, running into walls and falling over furniture. That's just, you know, a naturalistic explanation. It's kind of hard to tell exactly what Joe meant in this account, but I think it makes a little more sense than the whole demon ragdoll being thrown around the rafters of the house. So let's hear about Joe's handling of the situation. Quote, this is subtitled, The First Miracle in the Church. His situation was soon made known to his neighbors and relatives, and in a short time, as many as 8 or 9 grown persons had got together to witness the scene. After he had thus suffered for a time, I succeeded in getting a hold of him by the hand, when almost immediately he spoke to me and with great earnestness requested me to cast the devil out of him, saying that he knew he was in him and that he also knew that I could cast him out. I replied, "If you know that I can, it shall be done." And then almost unconsciously I rebuked the devil and commanded him in the name of Jesus Christ to depart from him, when immediately Newell spoke out and said that he saw the devil leave him and vanish from his sight. This was the first miracle which had been done in the church, or by any member of it, and it was done not by man, nor by the power of man, but it was done by God and by the power of godliness. Therefore, let the honor and the praise, the dominion and the glory be ascribed to the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, forever and ever. Amen. End quote. There we have it. The first self-proclaimed miracle the church had was performed by Joseph Smith himself, and it was a demon exorcism. I find it strange that the rate of demon possession, I mean, historically speaking, has been decreasing at an inverse rate compared to the number of people that have possession-like symptoms that are just suffering from a mental disorder, a viral infection, which we are now learning how to treat better every single day. At this rate, in less than a century, nobody will believe that demons are real and will actually be able to cure whatever mental illness causes a person to seize on the floor or throw themselves against the walls in a room. What I'm trying to say is, this is a pretty fucking lame first miracle. Joe couldn't give the young man pistol back and port the 2 inches back on his leg, thus eliminating his lifelong limp. Joe couldn't bring his dead child back to life. Joe couldn't miracle $3,000 out of thin air so Marty wouldn't have to sell his farm to finance the Book of Mormon. I suppose that back in this day, an exorcism was the closest thing they could get to empirically verifiable divinity claims. I mean, even today people believe in this shit. There are pastors that will give you a Skypercism for your demons for just a small fee. It's pathetic that this can be used as a confirmation bias of one's faith. And that's the point I'm driving at. And it fucking worked for the Knight family too, because they converted directly after. Back to the History of the Church, Volume 1, quote, this is subtitled, Remarkable Experience of Newell Knight. This scene was now entirely changed. For as soon as the devil had departed from our friend, his countenance became natural, and his distortions of body ceased. And almost immediately the Spirit of the Lord descended upon him, and the visions of eternity were opened to his view. So soon as consciousness returned, his bodily weakness was such that we were obliged to lay him upon his bed and wait upon him for some time. He afterwards related his experience as follows. Now this is supposedly quoting Newell Knight directly. Quote, I now began to feel a most pleasing sensation resting on me, and immediately the visions of heaven were opened to my view. I felt myself attracted upward and remained for some time enwrapped in contemplation, insomuch that I knew not what was going on in the room. By and by, I felt some weight pressing upon my shoulder and the side of my head, which served to recall me to a sense of my situation, and I found that the Spirit of the Lord had actually caught me off of the floor, and that my shoulder and head were pressing against the beams. End quote. Back to quoting History of the Church, quote, All this was witnessed by many, to their great astonishment and satisfaction. When they saw the devil thus cast out, and the power of God and his Holy Spirit thus made manifest, as may be expected, such a scene as this contributed much to making believers of those who witnessed it. And finally, the greater part of them became members of the church. End quote. So apparently, there were some witnesses to this experience. They saw Newell bouncing around the fucking rafters of the house, and then they saw Joe cast out the demon, and it made believers out of him. Well, that's the history according to Joseph and the History of the Church. Now, let's look at the surrounding evidence of what was happening at the same time and directly after this incident, and try and parse the truth out of the situation. This is my favorite part of the show. After this exorcism, the Knight family joined up and became participating members of the Colesville branch of the church. According to the church's account, this happened around the end of May 1830, but some shit goes down in June. On June 9th, the early Mormonites had the first organized conference in Fayette, with a self-reported membership of about 30 people, so they had grown a significant amount. After this, Joe decides to go check on the congregation in Colesville, roughly 100 miles away. The entire time that Joe was preaching in Colesville, there was a lot of opposition to him. Honestly, I can't put my finger on exactly why they hated Joe so much. You can try and chalk it up to the fact that Joe was preaching his new Jesus and pulling members away from the existing congregations. I mean, that really would have motivated local pastors to vilify Joe and turn everybody against him. However, that being considered, I don't think it fully explains what happened in June. It just doesn't make a whole lot of sense why people hated him so much. Joe was arrested and brought to trial twice in two different counties for being a disorderly person. That's a quote. From what I can tell, it looks like the first arrest happened in Colesville by a man named Joseph Chamberlain. The mobs had gathered, and they wanted to either beat the shit out of Joe or just straight up kill him. Apparently, while Chamberlain was walking Joe to the wagon they would be riding to South Bainbridge, The mob surrounded them the entire time and even crowded around the wagon. According to Joe's history, the mob was waiting for some kind of signal from the constable Chamberlain so they could just take Joe and have their way with him. The signal was never given, and the men took off in the wagon. After going a few blocks, a wheel fell off of the wagon, and the mob encircled the wagon again in hopes of taking Joe off of Chamberlain's hands. They repaired the wheel and made their way to South Bainbridge, where they would stay the night in a tavern. Even though they had traveled some 15 miles from Colesville to South Bainbridge, Joe was still afraid of a mob coming in the night to drag him out in the street to tar and feather him or just kick the shit out of him. The constable solved this problem by sleeping with his feet up against the door and a loaded musket in his hands. No attempt was made on Joe's safety that night. The next day, the trial commenced, quote, amidst a multitude of spectators, end quote. Once again, Joseph Knight Sr. comes to Joe's rescue. He was friends with two lawyers in Colesville named James Davidson and John Reed. Joseph Knight paid them to defend Joe, and they did quite well. I'm just going to read the supposed court proceedings from History of the Church, Volume 1, starting on page 89. There's some very interesting information couched in between the lines here, and I look forward to speculating in my usual way when we get to them. Quote, at length the trial commenced amidst a multitude of spectators, who in general evinced a belief that I was guilty of all that I had been reported concerning me, and of course were very zealous that I should be punished according to my crimes. Among many witnesses called up against me was Mr. Josiah Stowell, Boss Man Joe, we haven't heard from him in a while, of whom I had made mention as having worked for him some time, and examined to the following effect. Quote, so this is now the questioning of Boss Man Joe. Did the prisoner Joseph Smith have a horse of you? Yes. Did he go to you and tell you that an angel had appeared unto him and authorized him to get the horse from you? No, he told me no such story. Well, how had he the horse of you? He bought him of me as any other man would. Have you had your pay? This is none of your business. The question being put again, the witness replied, I hold his note for the price of the horse, which I consider as good as the pay. For I am well acquainted with Joseph Smith, Jr., and know him to be an honest man, and if he wishes, I am ready to let him have another horse on the same terms. End quote. Pretty interesting stuff here. Boss Man Josiah Stowell, who gave a very internally contradictory testimony on behalf of Joe during the 1826 trial, was called onto the stand once again to testify on behalf of Joe in this 1830 trial. Apparently, there was some sort of dispute about whether or not Joe was going to pay Boss Man Joe for a horse that he supposedly signed a note for. I think this just lays bare how convincing and smooth of a talker Joe really was. He had no money whatsoever to buy this horse with, and he had swindled Boss Man Joe out of quite a bit of money in their treasure-seeking adventures. Then Boss Man Joe thought it was a good idea to sell a horse to Joe, not for cash, but for a note of promised payment, which Joe had yet to make good on. And yet Boss Man Joe was still willing to sell Joe another horse on the same terms because he believed in the young prophet so much? There's just something deeply wrong with that, in my opinion. So let's move on to the next and somewhat similar testimony. This is a lawyer's examination of a Mr. Jonathan Thompson. Quote, Mr. Jonathan Thompson was next called up and examined. Has not the prisoner Joseph Smith, Jr. had a yoke of oxen of you? Yes. Did he not obtain them of you by telling you that he had a revelation to the effect that he was to have them? No, he did not mention a word of the kind concerning the oxen. He purchased them the same way as any other man would. End quote. So Jonathan Thompson was called to testify on Joe's behalf and did so. Much like the last testimony, for some reason the questioning lawyer thought that Joe had just given these guys revelation from God, stating that they should just give the livestock to Joe. However, once they were asked directly about this, they blatantly denied it, and said that they expected to receive payment from Joe for the livestock, just like any other sale between any other honest men. I wonder if they ever did get their money back out of Joe. I don't think we'll ever know one way or another on that point, so let's just move on to the part of the trial that I find most hilarious and exciting. Keep in mind, this is all the history of the church, Joe's recounting of this trial. This is not what we've taken from contemporary sources. Quote, "After a few more such attempts, the court was detained for a time, in order that two young women, daughters of Mr. Stowell, with whom I had at times kept company, might be sent for, in order, if possible, to elicit something from them which might be made a pretext against me. The young ladies arrived, and were severally examined touching my character and conduct in general, but particularly as to my behavior towards them, both in public and private. When they both bore such testimony in my favor as left my enemies without a pretext on their account. Several other attempts were made to prove something against me, and even circumstances which were alleged to have taken place in Broome County, which were brought forward, but these my lawyers would not admit of as testimony against me, in consequence of which my persecutors managed to detain the court until they had succeeded in obtaining a warrant from Broome County, which warrant they served upon me at the very moment that I was acquitted by this court." End quote. Apparently, after the court couldn't find anything to convict Joe with during all of the testimonies, only two of which were included in the official church history, Boss Man Joe's two lovely daughters were called up to the stand. Apparently, everybody in town thought that there might have been a little hanky-panky amongst these three hormone-crazed young adults. I don't tend to see a problem with this, however, they were probably calling it up in reference to adultery charges. I think everybody thought there might have been something going on there while Joe was married to the lovely Emma, which would justify the court charging him with adultery, or at least being a disorderly person on these grounds alone. Now, whether or not anything actually did happen between Joe and these two girls is irrelevant. The court couldn't find enough evidence in the girls' testimonies in order to convict Joe, or if they did, somehow they were out of the jurisdiction because apparently that happened in Broome County and this trial was going on in South Bainbridge. But regardless of conviction and actual testimonial evidence, I think it's worth talking about the possibilities here. We know that Joe liked his women, so much so that conservative guesses put him as having 34 wives at the time of his death. Do we honestly think that Joe wasn't a pussyhound at 24, but only later became one when he married his first polygamist wife, Fanny Alger, sometime around 1836? No, that's only 6 years after the time frame we're talking about right now. I can tell you from the perspective of a man that is currently in that age range when the somewhat newlywed Joe might have been fooling around with the Stowell girls, that it simply doesn't happen that way. The drive is always there, and it doesn't just increase the older I get. I'm willing to put my chips on the more controversial sides of the claim here. If Joe didn't actually mess around with these girls, I'm willing to bet that he was at very least flirtatious with them, and they were probably a little flirty back. I don't know if I would go as far as claiming that these girls may have been Joe's first threesome, because what guy doesn't dream of having a threesome when he's 24? I'm willing to bet that goes for straight and gay guys alike. There really isn't any way of determining that Joe did indeed go that far while being a married man, but it sure is fun to fantasize about as an ex-Mormon that used to hold so much reverence for this man and his manufactured piety. Moving right along, unfortunately we don't have the actual original transcript from this trial. What we do have is an abridged copy that was published in a newspaper less than a year after the actual occurrence. Let's cover this account. It includes a bunch of stuff that isn't in the history of the church version, and pretty much includes none of what the history of the church version has in it. The only way we know that these accounts are even of the same trial is because of the dates, charges, and some of the names match up. I'm inclined to believe that both of them are fairly accurate accounts, just incomplete in different places for different reasons. This is pulled from user.xmission.com, and I'll include a link to the webpage in the show notes. I'm not sure where they originally pulled it from, but that's the website that I used as a source here. Quote, "Abram Willard Benton of South Bainbridge, New York, wrote, 'This trial led to an investigation of his,' meaning Joseph Smith Jr.'s, 'character and conduct. which clearly evinced in the unprejudiced whence the spirit came, which dictated his inspirations. During the trial, it was shown that the Book of Mormon was brought to light by the same magic power by which he pretended to tell fortunes, discover hidden treasures, etc. You wonder why that part wasn't included in the history of the church. Oh well. Oliver Cowdery, one of the three witnesses to the book, testified under oath that said Smith found the plates from which he translated his book, two transparent stones resembling glass set in silver bows, that by looking through these, he was able to read in English the Reformed Egyptian characters which were engraved on the plates. So for some reason, the history of the church only talks about Joe getting a yoke of oxen and a horse from a couple of guys and talks about that business deal, but it says nothing about what we're talking about right here, or Oliver Cowdery being called up onto the stand or anything. Anyway, so much for the gift and power of God, by which Smith says he translated his book, two transparent stones, undoubtedly of the same properties, and the gift of the same spirit as the one in which he looked to find his neighbor's goods. It is reported, and probably true, that he commenced his juggling by stealing and hiding property belonging to his neighbors, and when inquiry was made, he would look into his stone and tell where it was. Josiah Stowell, a Mormonite being sworn, testified that he positively knew that said Smith never had lied to or deceived him, and did not believe he ever tried to deceive anybody else. The following questions were then asked him, to which he made the replies annexed. Now this is the examination of Josiah Stowell here. Did Smith ever tell you there was money hid in a certain place which he mentioned? Yes. Did he tell you you could find it by digging? Yes. Did you dig? Yes. Did you find any money? No. Did he not lie to you then and deceive you? No. The money was there, but we did not get quite to it. How do you know it was there? Smith said it was. Addison Austin was next called upon, who testified that at the very same time that Stowell was digging for money, he, Austin, was in company with said Smith alone, and asked him to tell him honestly whether he could see this money or not. Smith hesitated some time, but finally replied, this is supposedly quoting Joe, quote, "To be candid, between you and me, I cannot, any more than you or anybody else, but any way to get a living," end quote. Back to quoting the letter from X Mission. Here, then, we have his own confession that he was a vile, dishonest impostor. As regards the testimony of Josiah Stowell, it needs no comment. He swore positively that Smith did not lie to him. So much for a Mormon witness. Paramount to this, in truth and consistency, was the testimony of Joseph Knight, another Mormonite. Newell Knight, son of the former and also a Mormonite, testified under oath that he positively had a devil cast out of him by the instrumentality of Joseph Smith Jr., and that he saw the devil after it was cast out, but could not tell how it looked. That was written by Abram Benton in the magazine article Mormonites in the magazine Evangelical Magazine and Gospel Advocate, April 9th, 1831. There was plenty of information in there that was completely omitted from the officially recounted version by Joseph, including this Addison Austin guy talking to Joseph Smith and Joseph supposedly telling him that everything that he was doing was bullshit and that he couldn't actually see any money in the stone. I mean, when we're looking back on it now, it's like, well, yeah, no duh. That's, of course, Joe couldn't actually see it. But back then, people hearing that would have been like, oh, fuck, did you hear that? The lead fucking treasure hunter, Joseph Smith, actually can't see any shit in his magic stone precious. Oh, wow, well, maybe he's misled us with everything else that he's told us. But no, those accounts didn't exactly surface very well, apparently, or they were suppressed really well, either way. So, honestly, I gotta wonder why Joe would only include stuff that made him look like an honest guy. What's more, I wonder why this local magazine would include testimonies that were explicitly damning to the character of Joseph Smith and just write off the positive testimonies as almost uselessly biased because they came from Mormonites. Well, that's what we do on this show. We bring both sides to the table and see what makes the most sense. Hopefully there's some little nugget of truth hidden in those two different accounts. But before trying to summarize it all together and see what can be distilled from the information, we need to include the other trial. Almost forgot about it, didn't ya? Joe hadn't even left South Bainbridge yet after his first trial and was arrested by Constable Ebenezer Hatch for an arrest warrant issued by Joel K. Noble for a complaint filed by Samuel Dickinson against Joe, once again for being a disorderly person. However, this was in Broome County as opposed to the other one that was in South Bainbridge. Let's read the church history version of this trial and compare it with the much more complete secondary account of it that was copied directly from the docket book of Joel K. Noble. We have, oh dear, a bit of reading ahead of us. But like usual, the more we read, the more we begin to see into the personality of the person writing, or in Joe's case, dictating the writing to be written by Ollie or Joe Whitmer. I'm all about jumping in and out of the mind of Joe whenever we can, and I think this reading is extremely telling about Joe's perspective of the situation. This is backed into the History of the Church, Volume 1. Quote, this is subtitled, The Prophet's Second Arrest. The constable who served this second warrant upon me had no sooner arrested me than he began to abuse and insult me. And so unfeeling was he with me that although I had been kept all the day in court without anything to eat since the morning, yet he hurried me off to Broome County, a distance of about 15 miles, before he allowed me any kind of food whatever. He took me to a tavern and gathered in a number of men who used every means to abuse and ridicule and insult me. They spit upon me, pointed their fingers at me, saying, "Prophecy, prophecy," and thus did they imitate those who crucified the Savior of mankind, not knowing what they did. Oh, poor Joseph. I gotta admit, people spitting on me and making fun of me and insulting me and saying prophecy, prophecy would piss me off too. But I mean, come on, let's be honest here. Joseph, did you get whipped multiple times? Did you get a crown of thorns stabbed into your head? Did you get physically beaten and tortured? Did you get nailed to a fucking stake and then posted up on Golgotha? No. You got spit on and people were making fun of you with their words, and you're comparing yourself to Jesus, who was crucified. Are you serious? What a pussy. The next piece is subtitled Unnecessary Severity. We were at this time not far distant from my own house. I wished to be allowed the privilege of spending the night with my wife at home, offering any wished for security for my appearance, but this was denied me. I applied for something to eat. The constable ordered me some crusts of bread and water, which was the only food I that night received. At length we retired to bed. The constable made me lie next to the wall. He then laid himself down by me and put his arm around me, and upon my moving in the least would clench me fast, fearing that I intended to escape from him. And in this very disagreeable manner did we pass the night. Okay, so Joseph said, we're close to my house. Can I please just go home and spend the night with my wife instead of, you know, being arrested here? This sucks. And the constable was like, no, not going to happen. For some reason, this constable thought that Joe might try and make a run for it or something, or try to escape. So he had Joe lean against the wall right next to the constable, and he put his arm around Joe, and they slept like that so that if Joe moved at all, it would wake up the constable and he could, you know, stop him from running away. It's just, I think it's kind of telling of the character of Joe and what Joe was possibly saying at the time if we take into account the reality of this situation. All right, the next subtitle is The Second Trial. Quote, "Next day I was brought before the magistrate's court at Colesville, Broome County, and put upon my trial. My former faithful friends and lawyers were again at my side. My former persecutors were arrayed against me. Many witnesses were again called forward and examined, some of whom swore the most palpable falsehoods. And like the false witnesses which had appeared against me the day previous, they contradicted themselves so plainly that the court would not admit their testimony. Others were called, who showed by their zeal that they were willing enough to prove something against me. But all they could do was to tell something which somebody else had told them." Subtitled, Newell Knight versus Lawyer Seymour. "In this frivolous and vexatious manner did they proceed for a considerable time. When finally, Newell Knight was called up and examined by Lawyer Seymour, who had been especially sent for on this occasion." So the history of the church doesn't include any of the witness testimonies or the lawyer deliberations. It just jumps right down to Newell Knight's testimony. So let's see what Newell has to tell us about Joseph Smith. One Lawyer Birch also was on the side of the prosecution, but Mr. Seymour seemed to be a more zealous Presbyterian and appeared very anxious and determined that the people should not be deluded by anyone professing the power of godliness and not denying the power thereof. Mr. Knight was sworn, and Mr. Seymour interrogates him as follows. "Did the prisoner Joseph Smith Jr. cast the devil out of you?" "No, sir." "Why, have you not had the devil cast out of you?" "Yes, sir." "And had not Joe Smith some hand in its being done?" "Yes, sir." "And did he not cast him out of you?" "No, sir. It was done by the power of God, and Joseph Smith was the instrument in the hands of God." What a douche. "On the occasion, he commanded him to come out of me in the name of Jesus Christ." Oh, so it wasn't Joseph Smith who did it. Joseph Smith was just a Jesus tool. I don't know, he's kind of a tool bag for having his testimony going that way. "And are you sure that it was the devil?" "Yes, sir." "Did you see him after he was cast out of you?" "Yes, sir, I saw him." "Pray, what did he look like?" Here, one of my lawyers informed the witness that he need not answer the question, probably because it was hearsay. The witness replied, "I believe I need not answer your last question, but I will do it, provided I be allowed to ask you one question first, and you answer me." Oh dear, Newell Knight is about to destroy all of his own credibility, if he didn't do so already by saying that he saw the devil that Joseph Smith cast out of him. Okay, here we go. "Do you, Mr. Seymour, understand the things of the Spirit?" "No," answered Mr. Seymour, "I do not pretend to such big things." Oh God, nobody has the high ground on reality here. "Well then," replied Knight, "it would be of no use to tell you what the devil looked like, for it was a spiritual sight and spiritually discerned. And of course you would not understand it if I were to tell you of it." The lawyer dropped his head, whilst the loud laugh of the audience proclaimed his discomfiture. It's just fucking ridiculous. Nobody was talking any sense there, and the entire crowd was just laughing at how fucking stupid this was. Oh dear. "Plea for the state. Mr. Seymour now addressed the court, and in a long and violent harangue endeavored to emblacken my character and bring me in guilt of the charges which had been brought against me. Among other things, he brought up the story of my having been a money digger, and in this manner he proceeded, hoping evidently to influence the court and the people against me." So he just gave a standard closing argument that a prosecution lawyer is supposed to give? I mean, yeah, that's what's supposed to happen. "Mr. Davidson and Mr. Reed followed on my behalf." Those were the two lawyers that Joseph Knight Sr. had hired for Joe. "They held forth in true colors the nature of the prosecution, the malignancy of intention, and the apparent disposition to persecute their client, rather than to afford him justice. They took up the different arguments which had been brought by the lawyers for the prosecution, and having shown their utter futility and misapplication, they proceeded to scrutinize the evidence which had been adduced, and each in his turn thanked God that he had been engaged in so good a cause as that of defending a man whose character stood so well the test of such a strict investigation. Oh, God, what a douche, Joe. Just keep patting yourself on the dick there. Just keep calling yourself awesome. In fact, these men, although not regular lawyers, were upon this occasion able to put to silence their opponents and convince the court that I was innocent. They spoke like men inspired of God, whilst those who were arrayed against me trembled under the sound of their voices and quailed before them like criminals before a bar of justice. End quote. Oh, God, that was a history of the church's recounting of the situation. So before summing this all up, let's hear what the justice's account was like from his docket. This is the second part of the same page of the link that I said I'd include in the show notes. So if you're wanting to see these non-Mormon accounts of both trials, check the show notes for the link. This reading is a little longer than the one we just read, but I think it really sheds a lot of light on the situation, being a legitimate court document and whatnot. A little bit of bias shines through with a couple of the lines or questions in the actual docket. However, it's nowhere near as biased as Joe's account of the situation, and it doesn't seem to omit any of the important information from what I can tell. Unlike Joe, where he completely omitted all of the witness testimonies and then just jumped down to Newell Knight's testimony. Needless to say, this source is a fair amount more reliable than Joe's recounting of the situation. It's recounted 2 years after the actual situation, which is kind of a bummer, but it is a direct copy from the actual original document, meaning it's extremely trustworthy as an accurate historical document. Besides, that 2 years is nothing compared to 8 years after the fact, which is what we've been reading this whole time with every entry from the History of the Church, Volume 1. Just so you're prepared, it starts off as a newspaper article with a heavy anti-Mormon slant from the reporter, but it gets to the actual document we're interested in fairly soon. Quote, Mormonism from the New England Christian Herald, November 7, 1832, Boston, Massachusetts. We have before noticed the barefaced and outrageous delusion abroad in the country under the name of Mormonism. And though it is so shocking to common sense to reflect upon such a silly and egregiously absurd, though wicked, system, yet the public mind ought to be informed of every circumstance connected with the history of these deceivers and disturbers of good order and decency. Like I said, it's a little bit of an anti-Mormon slant to start off. We understand that Smith is now in this city, or has been within a few days, and a Christian community ought to arise and thrust him back to the den of his ignominy. A friend has requested us to insert the following account of the trial of Joseph Smith Jr. for a breach of the peace in, quote, looking through a certain stone to find hid treasures, etc., end quote. The account was published in the Boston Christian Herald some few weeks since, and the editor remarks, so this is the quote from the Boston Herald instead of the New England Christian Herald. Quote, our readers are probably acquainted with the origin of this sect and their Bible, and that two of the Mormonite preachers have visited this city and made a number of proselytes. Joseph Smith Jr. is the founder, a barefaced impostor. His moral character of the darkest hue, his name a derision, shunned by all decent society, and disowned by his pious father-in-law, meaning Isaac Hale. He has associated with himself characters, though of less intellect, yet equally base and profligate, and for some years has been practicing upon the credulity of the weak. Many have been swindled out of their property by these false prophets. Let others take warning. We extract the following from a letter by a gentleman in Windsor, Broome County, New York, acquainted with Smith, and entitled to confidence, to his friend in this city, dated August 30th, 1832. So this is a letter from somebody that was not a fan of Joseph Smith either, but we're getting to the court document eventually. Just hang in there. Quote, it is more difficult to obtain information of this kind than one would think, other than hearsay. The fact that Joseph Smith Jr. and others dug in various places for money is easily proved. At the Great Bend or near there, there was a company of digging part of 2 years could be easily proved. But that Smith said that there was money buried there by some Spaniards could not be so easily proven. Though it is generally believed, and also that towards the last of the digging there, he sold out shares in the treasure to as many as he could. And when he quit digging, said that the money had sunk down to a great depth. I have seen a hole 8 or 10 feet deep on the creek back of Captain Waller's, where it is said Smith said there was treasure. On Monument Hill, near to what is called the Monument, there is a hole dug 25 or 30 feet deep, where it is said Smith said that 2 veins of gold crossed each other as large as a barrel. On Mr. Samuel Stowell's flat, a hole was dug one night and filled again, and Smith was said to be one of the number. I might mention a hole on the backside of the hill over the river against where I live and other places if it were necessary, but I forbear. I called on several persons to gain what information I could. The most I could get was hearsay. Among others, I called on Mr. William Devenport, who went out with the Mormons to Ohio and has since returned. He says that he bore his own expenses out, but was often importuned by their leader to put his money into the common stock, and was told that those who did not would be struck dead the moment they arrived on the promised land, like Ananias or Sapphira. Wow, so apparently this William Devenport guy was early Mormonite that went to Ohio with everybody, and after this guy financed his own trip out to Ohio, Joseph told him that, hey, we need a little bit more money, and if you don't, you're going to be struck dead the moment you arrive in the promised land, so better give it up. Yeah, that's pretty much how it was. Joe was all about that. You better give it up to his people that were following him, to his buddies' wives and their daughters. Better give it up. Anyway, he said that the only object of the leaders was in this, to get the money into their own hands and keep it. He mentioned a widow Peck of Bainbridge, who, he said, paid in $500 and went with them, but could not get a cent on the way to procure something for a sick child. Said that he lived between 2 and 3 miles from where they settled in Ohio, and that Smith had a new commandment every few days through the summer a year ago. And that last summer, he thought there was not a fortnight in which he did not have a new commandment. Smith pretended to go into the woods and converse with the Almighty. Mr. Devenport said he had lately received a letter from William Yeoman's widow. Yeoman, there's that name. That's the guy that... Oh, wow. That's that guy. Okay, so Yeoman was somebody that was in the 1826 trial, but there was never a first name ascribed to him, so people don't know who he was. But apparently this has got to be him, William Yeoman, because they were people that went out to Ohio with the Mormons as well. Interesting. Mr. Devenport said he had lately received a letter from William Yeoman's widow, who went out with the Mormons and had since left them and gotten married, stating that a Mr. Rigdon, or a name that sounded like that, their principal preacher under Smith, said lately that the Mormon religion was not true, and in consequence had been silenced by Smith. Enclosed, I send you some testimony taken on trial in Colesville. Several offered to testify to what Newell Knight had said of Smith's casting a devil out of him. Some thought he had returned and would seem to allude to the unclean spirit mentioned in the Gospels. Okay, so just to sum that paragraph up real quick. Like I said earlier, this William Devenport guy went out and Joseph just bled him dry of all of his money and said, if you didn't give him money, then when you get to the promised land, you'll be struck down immediately dead by God. Then after that, there was this widow Peck who paid her last $500 into the church. And then when she was on the way out there to Ohio with everybody, she couldn't even get a cent to buy some cold medicine for her son to try and get him to heal. And apparently he had a bad fever or something to that effect. And then there was the Mr. Yeoman's widow, who went out there with the Mormons, and then she said that a Mr. Rigdon, I assume Mr. Hinchpin Sidney Rigdon, told her that the church wasn't true. And this was what happened in 1832. This letter was sent in late summer 1832. So less than 2 years into the church, there were people dissenting against it vehemently that were big movers in it, like Sidney Rigdon. I mean, this is passing on a first-hand account, so this is a second-hand account. We don't have the actual letter where Yeoman's widow told us that Mr. Rigdon said that it's false. But, I mean, second-hand account that's less than a year after it supposedly happened, there might be something to that. So, finally, we get down to the court document that we're really interested in this whole time. And this is the court document taken from the docket of Joel K. Noble. So, like I said, this is extremely reliable as a historical document. And even though it was reported 2 years after the supposed incident happened, it is fairly reliable. Quote, "The following is the report of the trial forwarded by the writer above and referred to in the letter. State of New York, Broome County, Justice Joel K. Noble. The People versus Joseph Smith Jr., Samuel Dixon, complainant. The defendant was brought before me by virtue of a warrant on the 30th day of June, A.D. 1830, on a charge that he, the said Joseph Smith Jr., had been guilty of a breach of the peace against the good people of the state of New York by looking through a certain stone to find hid treasures, etc., within the statute of limitation." That's an important part that he added in there, within the statute of limitation, because that serves to be the loophole that gets Joe out of this shit. "To the charge, the defendant pled not guilty. At the instance of the people, Joseph A. S. Austin was by me duly sworn, and says that he had been acquainted with Smith, the prisoner, for several years, that the prisoner pretended to look in a certain glass or stone, and he could tell where stolen goods were, and could discover mines of gold and silver underground, made some pretense at telling fortunes, but he, witness, never knew of prisoner's finding anything by his pretended art. Once witness asked prisoner to tell him if he, meaning the prisoner, could tell anything by looking in said glass, and wished a candid and true answer. Prisoner told witness frankly, he could not see anything, and, in answer, prisoner likewise observed to witness, anything you know for a living. Says 2 years before this present time, he saw prisoner drink a certain quantity of distilled liquor, and was drunk, as he does believe, for he could not stand up, but lay in the woods for some hours." Okay, so this is a second court document that is quoting this Joseph Austin guy, saying that Joseph told him that he can't actually see treasure in his looking glass. On two different occasions, in two different courts, this guy gave the same testimony. That's kind of damning. That's really, really strong. I mean, like I said earlier, when we're looking at it, we, in today's society, look back on it and say, well, yes, of course Joe couldn't actually see anything in that rock. That makes a lot of sense, but back then, a lot of people made a living by doing this glass looking or using divining rods. And if somebody that was making his living had somebody testify against their ability to make their living doing that, it'd be like, oh shit, no, oh, I can't believe he just said that. It's like telling a bricklayer that he doesn't know what mortar is. I mean, it's fucking fantastic. Next, it goes to a guy named Harris Stowell's testimony. Quote, "Being sworn by me, saith, he has been acquainted with the prisoner for a number of years past. That prisoner said he could look into a certain stone or glass, and could tell where money and hid treasures were, and could tell where gold and silver mines and salt springs were, and that Smith, the prisoner, the pretended prophet and money digger, had followed digging for money, for salt, and for gold and silver mines for a number of years. That others, by his instigation, had followed digging. That at one time, witness hid a bag of grain in his barn." So, Harris Stowell hid a bag of grain in Harris's barn. He told Smith he had lost a bag of grain and wished Prisoner to find it. Prisoner looked in his glass in vain, for he could not find it. Prisoner, after using all his art for a number of days, offered to give witness's brother 50 cents. So his brother told witness to find where the grain was and tell him prisoner, unbeknown to witness, so that Smith, the prisoner, might have the credit of finding the grain. So that was a little confusing, but what happened is Harris stole, took a bag of grain and went and hid it in his barn. And then he went to Joseph Smith and said, "Hey, I'm looking for this bag of grain. Can you help me find it? I'll pay you money to do it." So then Joseph tried for a week to find this bag of grain and couldn't. And then he went to Harris Stowell's brother and said, "Hey, I have 50 cents if you'll tell me where this bag of grain is. But don't tell Harris because I want him to think that I was the person who found it." He gave the 50 cents to Harris's brother. The brother told Joseph where the bag of grain was. He went and grabbed it and then took it to Harris and said, "Hey, look, thanks to Precious and Mr. Hat, I was able to find a bag of grain you've been looking for. Here it is. Kabam! Found it." The key was that Joseph told the witnesses, or told Harris's brother, "Hey, be sure not to tell Harris that I came to you for the location here." But, of course, being brothers and being, you know, they're trying to empirically test Joseph Smith, they shared, and Joseph Smith just looked like a fucking dumbass. I love it. Going back to the court document, quote, "Cross questions says he has not known the prisoner to look in glass within the space of 2 years last passed." That's an important piece of this. And now it's going to Josiah Stowell being questioned. "Josiah Stowell, being by me sworn, saith he had been acquainted with Smith, the prisoner, for quite a number of years, that he did pretend to tell by looking in a stone or glass where money and goods and mines were in a manner of peculiar to himself. The prisoner had followed digging for money, pretending to find mines, hid treasures and lost goods, and frequently others would be digging with him. Says that about 3 years since, prisoner was put under arrest by an officer at Bainbridge in Shenango County for breaking the peace, and that he escaped from the officer and went to Palmyra, and that about 2 years since, witness was at Palmyra and saw prisoner. That prisoner told witness that the Lord had told prisoner that a gold Bible was in a certain hill. That Smith, the prisoner, went in the night and brought the Bible, as Smith said. Witness saw a corner of it. It resembled a stone of greenish cast. Should judge it to have been about 1 foot square and 6 inches thick. He would not let it be seen by anyone. The Lord had commanded him not. It was unknown to Smith that witness saw a corner of the Bible, so called by Smith." Okay, hang on. Just the gravity of this situation is hitting me here. So up to this point, what had happened was Boss Man Josiah Stowell was up on the stand and testifying what he knew of Joseph Smith. He told the court that Joseph Smith had escaped from his 1826 trial after he was convicted, and then he ran back to Palmyra. And then after this conviction, he went to a certain hill and pulled the golden Bible from the hill, which that makes sense because 1827 is when he supposedly pulled the plates out of the hill. But then apparently Joseph had the so-called golden plates with him, and Josiah Stowell apparently saw a corner of it that was uncovered. He said it resembled a stone of a greenish cast, and he should judge it to have been about 1 foot square and about 6 inches thick. That isn't too far off of the what everybody else described it as. I think that possibly Joe might have had, if we're trying to give a naturalistic explanation for this, Joe might have had a stone, a big rock in there, and then he mounted a couple of pieces, a couple of leaves of just iron or whatever that people could thumb with, and then they would feel those and say, "Oh, wow, those must be the pages." And then there was a section that he called the sealed portion of the plates, but that was just the solid block stone that Josiah Stovall saw the corner of that was just some kind of greenish cast stone color. And Joe justified that by saying that's the sealed portion of the plates. That was why you can't feel the individual leaves in it. I'm trying to piece this all together, but it's starting to make so much sense. Josiah Stovall was the only person that has a that actually saw the plates, other than Joseph Smith. And he gave us a description of something that has a very naturalistic explanation that could have easily been created by somebody that was 20 or 22 years old. Wow, that's just fucking amazing. Josiah Stovall saw the golden plates. And they weren't gold. And they weren't plates. And they weren't a Bible. And they weren't what Joe considered it to be or claimed that it was. It was just a fucking green rock with probably some metal plates on top of it. Oh, wow. It's just, I'm sorry, it's just so fascinating to think about. Anyway, so-called by Smith told the witness that leaves were of gold. There were written characters on the leaves. Prisoner was commanded to translate the same by the Lord and from the Bible got from the hill. As aforesaid, the prisoner said he translated the Book of Mormon. Prisoner put a certain stone in his hat, put his face into the crown, then drew the brim of the hat around his head to prevent the light. He could then see, as prisoner said, and translate the same. The Bible got from Hill in Palmyra, at the same time under a lock and in a chest, and the prisoner, when looking for money, salt springs, hid treasures, etc., looked in the same manner. Did not know the prisoner could find lost money, etc. And that prisoner told witness after he was arrested in Bainbridge, he would not look for money, etc. Anymore, told witness he could see into the earth 40 or 50 feet, etc. Okay, so that was Bossman Josiah Stovall's account of what had happened there. And he said something very, very important there. Like I said, I had this the deliberation of what was actually that Josiah actually saw the plates uncovered, and Joe wasn't aware of that, or else Joe probably would have said something to him about it. Like, you know, don't tell anybody that they're not actually gold plates. But then after that, he said that he found the plates, the gold Bible, in the same manner that he would search for hidden treasures, that in that he could see 40 or 50 feet into the ground. However, he did say that the prisoner swore to not hunt for treasure after his previous court hearing in 1826. So therefore, it was after the statute of limitations here. Josiah Stovall's testimony served to damn Joseph Smith to historical inquiry. We can easily see that Joseph was a fraud this way. However, legally speaking, by terms of a disorderly person, Josiah Stovall actually helped Joseph Smith, actually excused his actions, and made it so Joseph was able to get off the hook. I just find it fascinating that there's a bit of a paradox there. It goes on to Newell Knight's testimony, and this is the only testimony that Joseph included in his own history of the church, so let's see how closely it relates to the Joel K. Noble accounting of the situation. I mean, you know, Joel K. Noble was the justice that was hearing this court case. Quote, Newell Knight sworn saith, quoting Newell, prisoner could see in a stone, as stated by Stovall, that formerly he looked for money, but latterly he had become holy, was a true preacher of the gospel of Christ, possessed the power of casting out devils. He knew it to be a fact that he, Smith the prisoner, had cast a devil out of him, the witness, in manner following. Witness's mind was impressed. He and Smith did conclude and knew the devil was in witness. They joined hands. Their faith became united. The devil went out of witness. Witness knew it to be a fact, for he saw the devil as he departed. Smith did it by the power of God, etc. A true copy from minutes taken by me on the trial. Joel K. Noble, Justice of the Peace, dated Colesville, August 28, 1832. Joseph Smith Jr. was discharged. He had not looked in the glass for 2 years to find money, etc. Hence, it was outlawed. End quote. There it was. Joseph Smith Jr. once again got off on the charges because it ran out of the statute of limitations. It was 2 years after he had supposedly been doing this, so people no longer had grounds to sue him on it. Therefore, he couldn't be criminally charged. That must have been a hell of a nail-biter trial for Joseph Smith, because he was about to be either fined or go to jail for being a disorderly person. But his buddies somehow gave testimonies that eked him out of this because of the small clause of the statute of limitations. However, us reading back on it nowadays, we're like, oh my god, Joseph was such a fucking fraud. It's just so abundantly clear with every one of those testimonies. I can't even believe it. I mean, it's just amazing. There are a couple of things that we have to talk about with this. I mean, I seem to ask this question in one form or another almost every episode. Why is it that the Mormon version of the history is so different from other versions of Mormon history, from secular or from non-Mormon historians? I seem to harp on this point a lot, but there are constantly inconsistencies with what we read from the church's reported history, to the point that some of the contradictions in perspective can't be easily reconciled. In the recorded Mormon history, Joe is always some kind of noble hero that's so despised by everybody he comes in contact with. Well, you know, everybody that didn't join his church anyway. Such a polarizing individual. You really wonder what it was about him that made people so desperately love or so violently despise him. I mean, the church that I know is a fair amount different than what Joe started up, primarily because the prophets nowadays are such white bread and warm milk compared to Joe. If I could meet a person like Joe today, it might be tough to resist falling into one of the similar bipolar categories. He was exciting, charismatic, and attention-grabbing, smooth, and extremely intelligent. He knew the basic Jesus speak of, you know, taking up your cross or calling people to repentance, and that gave him a level of legitimacy that few others could attain like he did. But the same personality type has its downsides. He was very megalomaniacal, and he thought solely of himself and rarely considered other people's perspective on his actions. He pretty much did whatever the fuck he wanted to, and he had the eloquence to make it all seem okay, or to make people that he was fucking over come to his defense in times of need. This was borne out with the various witness testimonies that we just read in the court. The only perspective that Joe included in his own history were those of confirmation of his divinity or piety in some way. Joe tried to portray himself as so much more than a man who just ran a church. That same attitude is reflected throughout the church today. They still whitewash the history to try and take the venom out of the more damning pieces of history. Well, this does a huge disservice to believing members of the church. The members should be trusted to learn the truth and make a decision themselves based on the truth claims of both sides and how closely the truth claims match reality. The church is treating its members as somehow incapable of judging the information for themselves and making a rational decision. That's one thing that bothers me so much about the church, and why I decided to do this podcast. I didn't want to be treated dumb anymore. I didn't want to feel like there was something that the church had to hide from me for fear of losing my attendance. Whenever things like these legal trials are brought up, believers love to write it off by saying something along the lines of, well, Joseph Smith was just a man and had temptations and problems just like the rest of us. I don't deny that. In fact, we don't talk about these problematic historical things just to bring Joe down to a human level. We talk about them because they're relevant. I want as clear of a picture of Joseph Smith as possible. If these trials were for something unrelated to Joe's church and doctrine, like public drunkenness and indecency, I would pay a lot less attention to them. I mean, who hasn't woken up naked in an alley after a long night of drinking? I mean, nobody is exempt from being a human and doing human stuff, but that's not what these trials are about. The definition is fairly broad when the legal term is disorderly person, but when we learn of the locals' opinions of Joe and reflect it with the questions and testimonies given and what Joe actually did as a person, it's easy to understand the scope of the legal violation that Joe was being sued for. Joe used his pet rock Precious and Master Hat to help people find things they were looking for. He would even go as far as taking something from somebody, hiding it, and telling them he could find it with his precious Seer stone if they just gave him a few shillings for his work. In Bossman Josiah Stowell's case, Joe buried a feather in the ground and told Bossman Joe that he saw treasure and a feather buried using his stone. When they dug into the ground where Joe had marked off and usually performed some kind of ritual, they found the planted feather, but no treasure. Joe clearly used this rock and hat trick to swindle people out of a living wage for his teenage to adult years. The damning implication attached to this practice was how Joe translated the Book of Mormon. I get so sick of people saying that Joe being convicted of fraud or glass looking or seer stoning or being a disorderly person has nothing to do with him being a prophet of God. He translated the fucking Book of Mormon the same way he swindled these people. Does that mean nothing? Is there really no connection there? Once you read the Book of Mormon with a skeptical eye and fact-check the little freak of a holy book for one goddamn chapter, it's so easy to see that it was brought about by a single person with a very limited understanding of biblical Christianity, and a child's comprehension of how the world works around them. Joe was such a fraud that it hurts. It actually makes my brain hurt when people call this man a holy prophet, when his prophecy method was the same failed method that he used to look for buried motherfucking treasure. It shouldn't be hard to knock the structure of every true blue believing Mormon's beliefs right off of its foundation. If we can prove that the primary mover behind the Mormon religion was everything that Joe was, our work is done. Unlike normal Christianity that can sort of survive without the Bible or twisting the Bible into an unrecognizable mess, Mormonism cannot survive without Joe and the Book of Mormon. It's disgustingly false, and we can prove that as a fact, more so than most other world religions. This past week has been quite a party on the Naked Mormonism Facebook page. I'm sure that some, if not most, listeners are aware of the recent revelation by the church. They posted pictures of the supposed seer stone that we've come to lovingly know as Precious. I recommend checking out the Facebook page to see the posts, but if you aren't much of a Facebooker, I'll find the original article from the Salt Lake Tribune and link it in the show notes. Personally, I fucking love it. The rock is beautiful and it fits most descriptions by the Chase brothers, Peter Ingersoll, and others. It's a small brown rock, egg-shaped, smooth, but unfortunately there isn't any way of knowing for certain that this is actually Precious. I remember watching a video of a talk by Grant Palmer when I first started my research into Mormon history. He tells about himself being a young man in the church and having access to things that most young men don't at that age. I believe it was just after his mission that he went into the church archive room. This was sometime in the 70s maybe, and there he saw multiple rocks that the church had. Most of them were claimed as being Joe's during different times in his life. But if I remember correctly, there were also stones from other church leaders in the group. I watched the video a long time ago, so I'll try to find it and include a link to it in the show notes. But I do remember hearing him say that, and my mind just fucking exploded. It was like the church knows about these rocks and doesn't show anybody except for the most worthy historians, the one they deem worthy anyway. Palmer having this experience was a once-in-a-lifetime kind of thing, and he didn't think much of it when it happened. He just thought they were some cool rocks that Joe had, and he didn't realize that there was so much story behind them, and they had been used for so much in the church's past. I'm pretty envious of this experience, to be honest, but it makes me so curious about what else is locked in the catacombs of the Mormon History Department. If we look at this revelation in the grand scheme of things, this was a very lame and unexciting revelation by the church. We've known since the beginning of the church that Joe used seer stones to quote-unquote translate the Book of Mormon, or give many of his various revelations that are now contained in the Doctrine and Covenants. It only took the church 171 years after Joe's death to come clean on this terribly menial detail of their history. What bothers me so much about it is the articles surrounding it. The church never explicitly comes by the connection between this stone and all of Joe's swindling shenanigans. Honestly, they just took pictures of the stone and said this is the stone Joe used to search for buried treasure during his youth. And they stopped there. They never talk about how the same technique was used for finding the gold plates or just with different stones, nor do they explicitly draw the connection to the actual translating of the Book of Mormon. The church tends to give one little inch of their doctrine and history once they're pushed up against a wall on it. I have yet to see a single historical revelation given by the church that would drastically change historians' perspective of the church in some way. Releasing these pictures is directly in line with what the church has always done. We know something exists in its history. Then we inquire about it, and the church directly denies it. Once the facts are too strong to deny it, the church becomes silent on the topic. Then people that know about this hypothetical thing we're talking about keep pushing, and the church quietly releases a document that somehow rationalizes and justifies that piece of history and puts their own spin on it. Like I said, releasing these photos this long after the fact is directly in line with what the church has always done. In the grand scheme of things, I couldn't really give half a fuck about the church coming by this honestly. I mean, the rock is cool looking, and it's nice to be able to put a mental picture with the name Precious, but really, this doesn't mean shit. We've known forever that Joe was using a rock like this for all his fun and games. The church was just nice enough to catch up with the times and come by it semi-honestly. What I want to know is what the fuck does the church have that we don't know about, that has some real impact on their history? Why won't they let historians traipse around in their basement for their dirty laundry? If the church is indeed true, then whatever's in its history should serve to bolster the faith of its members and bring questioning people into the fold with complete rational resolve. But for some reason, they still refuse to do so. If nothing else, the suppression of knowledge should be reason enough to abandon this multi-billion dollar conglomeration. They're really good at it. But I suppose that's just my opinion. Alright, let's move on to listener mail. Got an email from Craig, in reference to the last episode. I'm just going to read it really quickly. Wow, I just finished listening to your last episode, Boy K. Packer. I'm not Mormon, I'm Methodist actually. Middle-aged, married to a man, and just trying to learn as much as possible about Mormonism. Your podcasts are amazingly well done, and I learned so much history, but also about the personal struggles you and many others face. I must tell you, the last minutes of this most recent podcast had me in tears, as it brought up so many struggles I've dealt with in my own journey, involving church, family, and feeling like the other. You, sir, have a gift, and you are using it in a powerful and important way. Thank you for making yourself so vulnerable and sharing so honestly. What you are doing matters. Keep it up. Thanks. Craig, thank you for sending in that email. It really means a lot when somebody can empathize with something that I'm saying. Last episode, like I said, at the beginning of this episode, I kind of let my guard down and I talked a bit more about my own personal experience in the church. I don't like to do that much because I don't want this show to be about me ever. I want this show to be about the church and its history. But I feel like if there's a topic that has some sort of relevance to my personal experience in the church, I want to share it just so other people can empathize with it and hopefully it can help them somehow to see that they're not the only ones feeling the way that they are feeling, because it's important to have that sense of community. So, Craig, thank you for sending that email. It was very encouraging, and I appreciate it. And being a gay man, I hope that I didn't offend you with anything that I was said. Like I said earlier in this episode, I do apologize for the quote-unquote gay bashing terms. Also got an email from Travis. He apparently lives in D.C. and was on a bike ride recently through Rock Creek Park. He saw white spires off in the distance and found out that it was a Mormon temple, so he stopped at the visitor center to talk to the two female missionaries that were there, which that's pretty standard. Usually that's what the female missionaries do. They go work in visitor centers because I don't know why the church does it that way. So anyway, he apparently had a discussion with them. And gave them his information, which, dude, big mistake. Shouldn't have given them your information. But he got a book hand-delivered by a couple of elder missionaries the next week. Pretty exciting. Congratulations. That's always good fun. He also asked for some places where he can find some counter-Mormon apologetics or just anything to counter-Mormonism. There are a lot of good websites you can talk to them about, but missionaries can't look up websites. There's a lot of good books you can point them to, but they can't read anything that's outside of the approved Mormon book list. There's a lot of good podcasts out there, like My Book of Mormon, if they want to hear the Book of Mormon from a fairly unbiased, skeptical perspective of somebody reading it for the first time that doesn't know anything about Mormonism. That's a fantastic show to shed some light on the craziness that is Mormon and the Book of Mormon. For a good website, mormonthink.org, Grant Palmer, that I mentioned earlier in this episode, is one of the primary movers and bloggers on that website, and he is a Mormon historian and tells all kinds of really important stuff about Mormon history. It's one of my primary sources for information on this show. I highly recommend that, but like I said, there aren't a whole lot of places that you can point missionaries to that they can do some of their own critical thinking. The only thinking you can get them to do is just by talking to them. The best advice I can give you when you're talking to missionaries is you just have to be informed. You have to be more informed on what they're telling you than they are informed on it. So knowing the history to the extent that people that listen to this show know the history of the church is a very big tool, or having recently read the Book of Mormon or listened to the My Book of Mormon podcast, that's good, so you can talk about relevant Book of Mormon stories with them. Because when the missionaries come visit you, they will give you little snippets of sections that they want you to read out of the Book of Mormon to help bolster your faith or to help germinate the seed of your testimony that's lying deep within your heart. And hopefully you'll come to a realization that it's true by praying. And I mean, if you know more about the stuff that they're talking about than they do, you're instantly on a higher ground than they are. And my only advice is try not to ever tip your hand when you're talking to them. Don't ever let them know how much more you know about their stuff than they do, because they'll instantly think that you're an anti-Mormon. That's just what they think. The missionaries are created just for the sheer purpose of talking to people and bringing people to the fold that don't know anything about Mormonism already. They're just for people that are blank slates. So if they realize that you already know about the church and you aren't a member of the church, then they know that they need to stop talking to you. So just be careful. It's kind of a tough line to dance around. But yeah, there's a few different ways to do it. Let's see. Also, there's on YouTube, there's a lot of people that have published their a video monologue of their coming out stories. Those are really interesting because a lot of those, they're put on usually by the Ex-Mormon Foundation, and they're usually entitled "I Used to Be a Mormon" or something. But oftentimes, whoever is giving the monologue will tell something that they saw or heard, or some information that they came into that was really that forced them to question their beliefs. And there's a lot of tools that you can just pick up from listening to those testimonies of coming out that you can't really get anywhere else. So those are always a lot of fun to watch. So yeah, I hope that helps you out there, Travis. Thanks for sending in the email. Got an email from Olivia. Basically, she just wrote in saying that she really appreciates the show, and she wrote a long and emotional review on iTunes. But she wanted to do a little bit more and send in an actual email. Thank you for both, Olivia. I really appreciate it. Just all of your kind words in the email were just fantastic. They really helped to motivate me to keep going on the show. But more so, the iTunes reviews are something that really, really help out the show. They help to increase it in the rankings on the iTunes list. And anybody that is reading or that's checking out new podcasts, oftentimes they'll look at the reviews of what people are saying about it. So anybody that's looking at those iTunes reviews will have some sort of idea of what the show is about and what the people that are most vocal about the show think. And if there's a bunch of positive reviews on there, it's kind of hard to stay away from a podcast like that. So thank you for the positive review, Olivia. It was fantastic. And every time I read one of those iTunes reviews, my heart just goes all Twitter-pated and whatnot. So thanks for your email and the iTunes review. Got an email from Mary. You guys may know Mary by the episode 20, Demon Mary. She emailed and said, "Love the story. Believe it or not, I was a volunteer firefighter in a Bay St. Louis, Mississippi, while I was a full-time police officer. I did not die, but I did get to see some action." Mary, I just want to say you're a fucking badass, because I just make up those stories just for the fuck of it, just give Patreon donators something a little bit more, and that's fucking fantastic that you were actually a firefighter. Let me make this clear, though. Nobody in the translation stories die. They fucking get voiped before they die, and there's no deaths in my stories. But that's just fucking fantastic. Ah, what a badass. Anyway, thanks for sending that in, Mary. Got an email from Janice saying that she found the show via cognitive dissonance, and she's totally eating it up. She gave kind of her story out of the church, and it was really, really interesting. She was raised Mormon in Northern California, and where she says the Mormons are more of a curiosity than they are in Utah, as opposed to, I guess, the stat quo in Utah. But she sent in a link also that is her article that she wrote, quote, "a million years ago about my own experience," unquote. And I'm going to leave a link for it in the show notes, because it was pretty interesting to read it. She kind of laid it all bare and gave her perspective very, very, very well. And I encourage anybody that wants a female perspective from the church, somebody transitioning out of the church, it's definitely worth the read. It's on Chopped Liver Productions. Like I said, there'll be a link for that in the show notes. Got an email from Hal Prentice, long time listener of the show since the beginning. Hal, he was one of the earliest people to have any correspondence on the show and talk about Mormon shit with me, and I just enjoy talking with you so much, Hal, and getting emails from you. They're so heartening and exciting. He's been a Patreon donator for most of the time the show's been running, and he also made a one-time PayPal donation. So, Hal, thank you for being awesome, for being you, and for just being super badass. The show has been made so much better with your correspondence and with your contributions and everything. Not just the money contributions, but your information, what you've told me about and everything. Just awesome. Thank you so much, Hal. I feel very, the word that comes to mind is blessed. I feel very blessed having made your acquaintance, Hal, but, even if the word blessed doesn't really make any sense, I hope that the sentiment is still conveyed. Got an email from Greg. This was a pretty interesting email that turned into a little bit of correspondence. He said that he started out, he was born and raised brainwashed in the Mormon church. He was getting the occasional doubt as young as 11, me too, but he stayed in the church till he was 20, started mission when he was 19, and then stayed 10 days in the mission field and then left. And I just had to say that that had to be such a mind fuck. To go out on your mission for 10 days and then get a dishonorable discharge. I can't even imagine how painful and crazy that would be. He says, when it comes down to it, he's lucky. He stopped attending church, dropped out of BYU of Idaho officially, and then started seeing an actual reputable psychologist as opposed to a Mormon psychologist, which is, I had my own experience with one of those and wasn't a big fan. He sent in his resignation letter and he did this all at the age of 20. It's just interesting to see his pain and frustrations come through in the email. It's really, really, I empathize with it a lot. I'm sorry to see it and sorry to hear it, but I know that this is just symptomatic of what the church does. He closes up the email with saying, "The reason I'm writing you is because you state that this podcast is a form of therapy for you, which I've said a few times. I wanted to know if you've gained any insight as to a way to escape the idea that a life without an afterlife is a pointless life. I'm an atheist. It was hard coming to terms with reality, but I did. I still can't escape the idea that my life as an atheist is one without meaning." I couldn't help but truly correspond with that. So I ended up sending him a fairly lengthy letter on my experience.
So I'm going to read back a bit of the email that I sent to him, because I feel like it sums up my stance on that topic much better than I can try and just ad-lib it right now. So, let's see. I'm glad you've been seeing a reputable psychologist, as opposed to a church-appointed one. When I was going through a depressive phase in my teens, I went to a psychologist counselor that seemed to help. But when I was in a particularly depressive place, he asked some very theologically driven questions that made me question things I had not questioned before, and made me extremely angry with him and the entire situation. He seemed to use my mental state as a point of advantage to try and assert the holiness of the church and God, and it only served to send me into a spiral with no landing pad. I long since recovered from that depressive episode, and I attribute very, very little of that to the counseling sessions or the meds. It took a fundamental change in my outlook and passing a Coca-Cola billboard on the road to really get to where I am now. I'm happier than I've ever been, and my relationships with people are much stronger and more genuine than I had ever experienced before this change in my mindset. This change isn't something that I can easily quantify, but I'll try to describe it, as I think it relates to what you asked at the end of your email. By age 17, I had recently left the church, but was still stuck in a very believing household. I spent all my time working, going to school, or playing video games, trying to separate myself from something that I was completely surrounded by. I hadn't questioned my existence, nor did I much care for questions of theology or philosophy. All I cared about was my day-to-day life and holding tightly to the few relationships I still had. Most had dissolved with my lack of church attendance. I treated everything and thought about everything on a very short scale. That might not actually mean much, but I can only describe it by my attention to my own life. I only paid attention to what happened each individual day with no connection from the last to the next day. I was infuriated by very small inconveniences. I didn't pay much mind to anybody other than myself. I didn't care for time with family. For lack of better terminology, I was living an extremely shallow life and was rather unhappy. Then I made this fundamental shift I referred to earlier. I dropped out of college, moved out of my parents' basement, started smoking lots of weed, and got an actual adult job driving a truck, and began meeting lots of new people. A pleasant byproduct of the new job. I found that the less time I spent around my family and their insatiable questions about where I was in relation to the church, the happier I became. The more I separated myself from the so-called sins I was committing and began just living my life doing what I wanted to do, the better off I became. My base level mood slowly lifted itself out of the dumps it had been smashed into by my previously Mormon mindset. It seemed like the more I ignored what everybody was telling me was the most important thing in life, the more my life had importance to me. Then I saw the billboard that was the one small catalyst behind this change in my life. It seemed so insignificant every other time I had driven past it, which was every day for my driving job. But one day when I was headed south on I-15 through downtown Salt Lake, this Coca-Cola sign finally stood out to me with two simple words that seemed to quantify everything I had been trying to do for so long. I hadn't realized I was doing this, but once the words were there, I couldn't help but retroactively apply it to the transition I was coming through and use it as a tool for everything in my life after the transition. The sign simply said, "Enjoy everything." It was so easy. It made so much sense. I hadn't figured it out, but that's exactly what I had been doing recently. I had been enjoying everything because everything was there for me to enjoy. It didn't take long for me to slap these two simple words on everything I was doing. Even in unpleasant situations, I was able to tell myself, "Why be mad? Just enjoy everything." It may seem so stupidly cheesy and hopelessly insignificant, but that single phrase is something I still repeat to myself whenever I find myself not enjoying life. That and fuck it whatevs. Fuck it whatevs got me into new and exciting situations, and enjoy everything forced my mind into enjoying whatever situation it was that fuck it whatevs got me into. These two little tools brought brand new perspective on my life, and it's something I can only refer to in vague profundities and lame anecdotes. I was working my way through age 20 when all this was happening. Now I'm 4 years into my new perspective, and I couldn't imagine myself happier any other way. So how does this all relate to having a meaningful life? Well, a phrase that's thrown around in atheist circles is something along the lines of, the point of life is life itself. Life is as meaningful as you make it. While these seem like somewhat hollow phrases when compared to the eternal perspective that a theist may have, it serves to focus on the more important things. We shouldn't have to die in order to truly live. It reminds me of a Ricky Gervais quote. It's a strange myth that atheists have nothing to live for. It's the opposite. We have nothing to die for. We have everything to live for. So when you ask, what is the point of life, I can only answer with an ambiguous half-answer. The point of life is whatever point you want your life to lead to. We are atheists. We make our own point to life. We make our own happiness, and we don't need a god or religion to tell us otherwise. That's about the best I can do in answer to your massively philosophical and theological inquiry. So that was the reply email that I sent to Greg. I figured that it quantified my stance on the meaning of life much better than I could try and describe in quick terms. It probably would be better off to have just skipped all of that because it was boring, but oh well, that's my perspective on it. Also had a bit of correspondence with Will. He said he was born Mormon, and he's a fifth generation Mormon. But he went to the church up until his 18th birthday. Has a couple of brothers who are also ex-Mormons, so it's not really that big of a deal that he's kind of an ex-Mormon, but he's still sort of an ex-Mormon in the closet. He said that he hasn't been going to church for the past 5 months now, and his atheism started when he was 17. The biggest thing in his letter that hit me was the fact that when he left, that there was really nobody that seemed to care much. Like, when you're in the church and you are thinking about leaving, you think of how tough it's going to be because all of your friends and family will be coming to you constantly and, you know, crawling to you on their knees, hoping that you'll come back to the church and the fold. But it's just not like that when you leave. More often than not, when a person leaves, they might get a visit from one church leader or from one friend in the church, but they never go into a discussion with you or anything about it. They just say, hey, or how are you doing? Is there anything we can do for you? And it's a little disheartening because it's not how I pictured leaving the church. And from what I could get from the email from Will, it's not what he expected either. And, you know, I think that's probably for the best because I didn't want to be beaten over the head with the church. When I left, I just had one church leader that stopped by he just came by to borrow a tool from my dad, and I just happened to be outside there with him. And when I walked up to this church leader, he was just like, oh, hey, Bryce, how you doing there? Haven't seen you at church lately. Is there anything I can do for you? And that was it. That was the extent of people coming to me and saying, hey, is there, you know, what's going on? Why aren't you coming to church? I didn't really get that much. Even from my family members, my extended family members, I didn't get that. It's really, really surprising. But yeah, thanks for the little bit of email correspondence. That was fun, Will. Got an email from Hank, just saying that he's enjoying the podcast, and something that he said kind of hit me here. I'll just read the end of his email. They never cared that I didn't go on a mission, talking about his parents, because they were more liberal Mormons, lucky you. Even with this environment, now that I'm out of the church, I feel it has left me socially retarded. I'm used to making friends through church. Now I'm trying to relearn those skills. The way the church likes it, you function properly inside of their rules and have trouble functioning outside of it. Keep fighting the good fight. Hank, I could not agree more with you. That's one thing that's left me frustrated a lot is I find when I'm talking to people, I'm often things that seem normal to me are completely outside of the realm of normal social mannerisms. Things that are completely normal in the church, even down to just phrases of speech. And yeah, I agree. It's left me socially retarded too, man. I agree. The church does a good job of creating this insular environment that you can function inside of, but it's hard to function outside of the boundaries of what they dictate. Thanks for sending the email in, Hank. Got an email from Matt. He said that he's not Mormon and his sympathies are much towards traditional Christianity and conservative than mine. Let's see. I'm just going to read the end of his email here. The podcast special edition episode 3 that I listened to yesterday prompted me to write. You were discussing Not So Smarty Marty and how he could be so successful and yet so foolish. I grew up with Not So Smarty Marty, with a front row seat. My dad was and is the exact same thing, a classic bipolar. It's not that these people are non-functional loonies at all. My dad was an airplane pilot with a lot of money and is broke today. Yet the similarities to the hyper-superstitious, religious, conspiratorial bullshit that, going from one crazy-ass thing to another and being super susceptible to every suck-up, manipulative crook that comes along. It's them. What is amazing with these people is how you can dead nuts prove the total fraud of the issue at hand, and these people will blow it all off, excuse everything, and keep going with it. Years later, they still can't even admit being a chump. I honestly believe they passed a lie detector. I just had to laugh out loud to keep from crying. Others I know living with bipolars will tell you the same general thing. Thanks. Matt, I agree, and I didn't really consider that perspective. I think, yeah, it's not baseless to assert that Not-So-Smarty Marty was bipolar in some sense, or had at least those tendencies where he would just believe some things wholeheartedly and then completely flip-flop one day to the next. And I mean, he left and came back to the church multiple times throughout his life and then ended up dying in the Utah Territory underneath the rule of Brigham Young. I mean, there's a lot of shit that Not-So-Smarty Marty was involved in that his theological convictions and his comprehension of everything Jesus had a big factor on what he was doing and shit. I mean, if it weren't for him and his susceptibility to hucksters like Joseph Smith, we wouldn't have the Book of Mormon to talk about today. So, yeah, nicely said, Matt. Very poignant. Got an email from Jessica. She said that she was married in the church and has since left the church. When she was leaving, she told herself that she was doing it for the safety of her three girls, basically. She didn't want them to endure what she did in growing up in a fundamentalist church. She also says that it turns out that living two states away and raising them in a non-religious atmosphere still doesn't make them immune from the guilt, the shame, and the passive-aggressive behavior. Yeah, unfortunately, it's not just Mormonism. It's symptomatic of the entire Protestant Christianity that has plagued our society and its comprehension and stances on human sexuality and morality. So, yeah, there's no escaping it, and I'm sorry that your girls do have to deal with that. I'm sorry that all girls growing up have to deal with it. It's fucked up beyond all belief. But beyond that, she says she's done a lot of research into church history. She's been in Nauvoo, into the Mountain Meadows massacre site, and it's all really overwhelming, basically. And she says that she would like to contribute to the show, whether by knowledge or by finances. I mean, financial support for the show is appreciated, and half of the show's profits go to the organization Holding Out Help, which helps polygamist families transition out of polygamist cults in Colorado City and in northeastern Utah and, you know, some of the more crazier parts of the country. So having the financial support is really nice, but what I look for the most is just correspondence with people. I really just want to know what you know about the church. I don't know if there's any certain topics that I can really petition for people to research or anything. And this doesn't go out to just Jessica. If you guys know stuff about the church history that you think I don't know, or you think that would be pertinent for me to know or include in the show, please, please send me an email or send me a Facebook message or post on the Facebook wall something about it or a link. I'm always looking to expand my knowledge so I can be more knowledgeable and bring that as a tool to the podcast. But it's not really as simple as just saying, well, you know, I know a lot about the church, so if you need me or if you need me to do any research on stuff, tell me. I don't know what you know about, so I can't ask you to do, you know, I can't petition for your knowledge if I don't know what you know. So to Jessica and to anybody else that wants to contribute information to the show, please do not hesitate to do so. Even if you just send me down a rabbit hole of just link clicking and finding something out new or just reading some article that I've never seen before, please, please fire away. I'm always interested in expanding knowledge. So thank you for the email, Jessica, and I really hope to, you know, have some correspondence with you in the future. And that goes for anybody that knows about Mormon history that knows something that I don't know. Let's make this a crowdsource research project. Got a couple of one-time donations that I forgot to make mention of. got donations from Matthew and Janice. You too. I really appreciate those. You guys, the one-time donations are really a big help. I mean, while Patreon is nice, the one-time donations are really appreciated as well. Also got another email from Janice. I addressed your first email, but then when you sent in the second one, I had to come back and address it as well. So she just kind of sent her a little bit of her story, which was really fascinating to read, how she said that she just finished binge listening to the whole series. I hope you enjoyed it. And then got to the episode about Boyd K. Packer. She said the ending of that episode, well, it could have been written by me, except it wouldn't have been as well written, and I'm pretty good. Thank you for that. She goes on, I have said for many years that the Mormon Church was a brick wall between my parents and myself, and I sorely miss the relationship we could have had without that goddamn brick wall. Janice, I totally feel what you're saying there. Hope I made it clear in the last episode that I empathize with that same thing, that same phenomenon that a lot of Mormon people go through when they transition out of the church. So, yeah, you're not alone, and it's good to talk with people and get emails from people that are experiencing the same thing that I'm experiencing or somehow empathize with the way that the last episode ended. The rest of her email is just really interesting and just slightly depressing at times, but it's really inspiring and it's just amazing. She tells her story about her brother going into the bishop and talking about masturbation. We all had to go through it. She talks about arguing with her sister and her children about the facts and, you know, trying to send them links and so on and so forth. And I mean, I totally empathize with that whole situation. So, Janet, keep up the work, and wish you the best of luck in the fight. Also had to talk about an email from Stephanie here. She also said that she enjoyed the last 10 minutes of the Boyd K. Packer episode. Her email was a little bit shorter, so I'll just read straight from it. I was emotionally touched by the last 10-ish minutes of this episode. I assume she's talking about the episode with Boyd K. Packer. I was in tears. I felt like I'll never be normal because of my Mormon upbringing. And there are times that I feel misplaced and weird because of it. I can't relate to Mormons anymore because I'm not quote-unquote in. But I can't relate to non-Mormons because my mind is so warped by my LDS upbringing. I'm 32, been married for 12 years, I have 3 kids. I didn't get to grow up, she was married at 20, and explore because I was brainwashed into thinking that motherhood is what would finally prove my worth. It pisses me off to hear that because it's such a recurring theme and built into the structure of Mormonism that women are just little spirit baby factories. It's fucked up. Back to her letter. I don't regret my marriage. I got lucky. We both left the church. Congratulations to that. And I don't regret my kids most of the time. Right. That's why I don't have kids. But I do feel deeply angry that my free agency was taken away by the very organization that taught about being free to choose. It's just amazing. Thank you for your email, Stephanie. That was, I really appreciate you sending that. It means a lot when I hear a story of somebody that's really empathizing with the same thing that I'm coming to grips with right now, just with my relationship to people and how I perceive myself in the world. It's very proprioceptively masturbatory, but thank you very much for helping me reflect like that. I enjoyed it quite a lot. And the last thing that I had to splice in was talking about the recent Mormon revelation of the Seer Stone that, you know, Precious, that Joe supposedly had. I recorded earlier a segment about my opinions on it, and my opinions haven't changed at all. However, I do feel kind of wronged. I do feel like the wool has been pulled over my eyes here, because the really interesting thing that was coupled with that revelation the church gave was something that was much more pertinent to Mormon history and more interesting to Mormon historians. The church released the manuscript copy of the Book of Mormon. They released both of these at the same time, and it was in this book series they released called the Joseph Smith Papers. And the papers are basically just pieces of the history that the church has come to grips with that they have to address in one way or another. And that's where they released all the photos of this Seer Stone that we've been seeing the news articles about. Well, the much less popular news article is the one that shows the pictures of the original printer's manuscript. When I heard about the story that they released pictures of the stone, I was like, oh, wow, that's, I already gave my opinion on it. It's perfectly to be expected from the church, but it wasn't expected when it came. But it's kind of odd that they would release both of these things at the same time. They would release the revelation of both of these things to their members and to the press, and they would kind of, it seems like one of them caught a little bit more press, and they might have just kind of slipped the other one under the rug trying to make it so it didn't receive as much press. I find that fascinating because that is the thing that Mormon historians are so interested in. I mean, plenty of historians have seen the rocks before now, and they're fascinating, and, you know, it was really cool to actually see a picture of them. But actually having the printer's manuscript and the RLDS Church and the LDS Church teaming up in order to bring these to light and bring them out and author them and put photocopies of them into a new book, this is, it feels like I kind of got squirreled here. They kind of like, hey, you see this rock in my hand? Hey, you know, yeah, that's a pretty cool looking rock, isn't it? Just don't pay attention to what my other hand is doing. But look at this really cool rock. It's egg-shaped and brown, and it's got all these cool lines through it. Yeah, Joseph Smith used this to go hunt treasure, but we don't know, you know, why the church still has it. But here it is. You know, it's pretty cool, isn't it? Oh, those papers over? Yeah, don't worry about the papers. They're just papers. They don't have anything important on them. Just don't pay attention. I don't know. I'm reading into it like there's a nefarious agenda behind it, and I shouldn't be doing that because that's not very objective. But I don't always like to be objective in what I talk about in this show. So, church, just let us go look. Just let people that are interested in the history of the church go look in your archives and see what's there so we can make judgments about the church ourselves. Well, that's all I ask. That's all I want. That will make me a very, very happy person, and not just me, but thousands of other historians and millions of members of your church would be very happy to know that you let objective historians go rooting around for your dirty laundry. I did just want to say that for the month of July, the Patreon donations, half of those will not be going to Holding Out Help this time around. However, what they are going to is an upgrade in the equipment. The laptop that I have been working off this whole time is, to be put in nice terms, it's a little obsolete, and I'll spend entire days just compressing or processing files that are, it's just a huge waste of time, and there's tons of frustrations with it. So, listener John contacted me and said that he has a laptop that he is looking to sell, and it's a gaming laptop. Got that in the mail, and this thing is fucking badass. But, I mean, but of course, I did buy it from him, and that's what this month's patronage is going to, is this major upgrade in the equipment of the show. This is going to save me a lot of time, and I really appreciate your correspondence on that, John. It's a hell of a laptop. I like it. Thank you. There's a few new Namo juvenile delinquents to thank here. We have Jer, I guess, or Jer, I'm not sure exactly how to say it, Laramie, Martin, Josh, Francine, and Jason. Thank you all very much for contributing to the show and being a Namo juvenile delinquent. Your journey through the Namo Outer Darkness Kingdom is just beginning, and there's a long road ahead of you. Next, there was one Namo adolescent rebel to thank. Brandon, thank you very much, Brandon. Your patronage has reserved a spot for you in the deepest cavities of the heart of the podcast from now till the end of eternity. So thank you very much, Brandon. There is a new, never-before-seen Namo presence that wanders throughout the Namo Outer Darkness. We don't know much about it yet, and I look forward to coming to some level of understanding of this. Daniel, thank you for your support. I look forward to being in touch with you very, very soon for what you're doing. I did want to say that at the time of recording this, I'm going to be on Atheists on Air. That's Sunday, August 9th. By the time this episode comes out, that will have come out the Monday before, so hopefully you'll go check out that episode, Atheists on Air. It's all about Mormonism. We got David Michael. As I'm told, we might have David Fitzgerald as well, who wrote the Complete Heretic's Guide to Western Religion, The Mormons. Really, really looking forward to doing that recording, and it's going to be a lot of fun hanging out with those people. I haven't been on that show in quite some time, so looking forward to talking with Professor Steven and Rachel Nanu Nanu Brown, and yeah, everybody else that'll join in. It's a live call-in show too, so doesn't really do much good to tell you this now, but if you want to talk to me, call in and see what happens. It ought to be fun. So yeah, I'm really looking forward to being on that show. I think that's everything that needed to be addressed. I'm not sure what next episode's going to be about. I assume we're just going to move along in the timeline, but I don't have any structure set out or any idea of exactly what it will be. So hope you join me, and I look forward to talking at you next time here on the Naked Mormonism Podcast. I know, it has been a long time since I've done a bonus on an episode, so I might as well get one out now, because I found something that was fucking fantastic. It was one more testimony in one of the trials that we didn't read that I just didn't want to include because it was taking so much time anyway. That's the thing, before I read this, I do want to tell you that sometimes the history and the scripting will get away from me a little bit. The length of this episode was kind of unintended, and all the extra listener mail to get to was took more time than I thought it would. But sometimes when the topic is just too juicy, too exciting, I can't keep to 90 minutes with the history because there's so many things that are connected to it that I just don't want to leave out. So sometimes, I hope you guys don't mind, I'm going to have episodes that are a little bit longer than what the average is, just to get in a few extra pieces. So here it is, the final witness testimony in the second court transcript that we were reading. Quote, Preston T. Wilkins, known by me to be the same person and being by me duly sworn, saith, that Newell Knights did style himself a prophet of the Lord and was ordained by Joseph Smith Jr., the pretended author of the Book of Mormon. As the said Newell told him, this deponent and this deponent understood so by others, that the said Newell was so ordained, that the said Newell told this deponent he knew past, present, and future that in order to ascertain the prophetic ability of the said Newell, the deponent went and took from the father of said Newell a Mormon Bible, so-called, unbeknown to anyone. As this deponent believes and buried it under his own doorstep, that was meaning the witnesses, in the morning the book was found. This deponent went to the aforesaid Newell, told him the mystery that had happened. The said Newell and father told this deponent it did not come from this package of books. They counted them and were certain. As they said, the aforesaid Newell told this deponent that God told him, the said Newell, that he had sent his angel to put the book on the doorstep to convince him, this deponent, of the truth of the Book of Mormon, as also to warn him to flee from the impending wrath. Oh, I had to read through that so many times to get that straight. So, this is fucking crazy. But as far as I can tell, this was during the time that the book had been published, and Newell wasn't sure if he wanted to become Mormon yet. So Joseph, apparently hid a book, you know, somewhere like under Newell's bed or somewhere that he would find it. So Newell found the book and he went to Joseph Smith and Joseph Smith Sr. and said, "Hey, I found this book. Are you guys missing one? Because I found this book was just laying down in my room on the floor." And Joseph said, "I sent my angel to put the book on your doorstep to convince you of the truth of the Book of Mormon and to warn Newell to flee from the impending wrath." Holy shit. That's like, what a douche nozzle move, Joseph. Like, that's how you have to go get a member to your church. You go hide a book and then tell, you know, when they wake up and find the book and say, "Hey, is this yours?" You say, "Oh, I sent my angel to bring that to you just to convince you that it's true." It's, oh, wow. It's just fucking amazing. Wow. I didn't fully understand the gravity of this when I pasted it at the end. I only read through it once. Now I understand the whole situation after reading it six times to figure it out. Wow. That's amazing. I just had to have in a little piece of bonus content, and it turned out more epic than I thought I was going to be. All right. See ya.